Get a grip on this operation, Heather. That's Bourne. Green light the asset.
Sir, I need more time.
We have no time.
Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is September 20th, 2016. And I'm coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com into the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the ideas of the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are always happy to hear from you. You can reach us by phone at 702-470-7664 or via Skype username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. It's all one word. And you can get all that information and more at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, which features all the links to our social media, Facebook, Twitter, as well as original articles, blogs. Right now, I'm in the middle of a series on the drug war, or what I titled the drug war, why things should go back to how they were before the 1920s, because in 1914, they passed the first law. It was actually the first law that not only limited drugs, but limited really anything. It was the first law in which the government started to tell people what they can put in their own bodies. So it was actually a landmark type of thing. And unlike alcohol, which they added a constitutional amendment for some reason with drugs, they thought they could do whatever they want because technically, that would be a state issue, not a federal issue. So you shouldn't have any federal, there shouldn't be any federal drug laws according to the Constitution. But as we know, they just do whatever the fuck they want anyway and don't follow the Constitution. So that's the government for you. Before we get to our guest, we have a guest tonight. We'll be talking to Brad Miller and talking about his experiences and all about medical freedom. But before we get to that, I wanted to talk briefly about a story that I had seen today. And I'll actually bring Brad on as well in case he wants to comment, and then we'll get to how Brad found the ideas of liberty, as well as some other things that we want to talk to him about. So, Brad, thank you for coming on.
Thank you, Dave, for having me. I'm excited to be here.
So the story I want to talk about, it had to do with, of course, another police shooting. Most people don't know there are about close to five a day. Now, that doesn't mean that there are five unarmed people a day that get shot, but most of them, we don't know the actual story of what happened because you're just going by the cops and there's not video for the majority of people that are killed by police. A lot of them that I've seen, because I've read a lot, killedbypolice.net, I believe, tries to keep track of everyone, and they do a pretty good job, and they attach an article so you can get the name of the person and do further research. And I did that once for like a sample size of maybe like 60 people and tried to analyze even race and things like that. And it's people of all races that are getting killed. But a lot of them are either, there's a lot where people are mentally ill and they shoot them, or they're depressed and suicidal and somebody calls the police and the police end up killing them, or they claim the person had a knife. I don't know how many they claim. Well, the person had a knife and he came at me, and there's no video. So how do you even know? To plant a knife is really easy. And why would somebody run at a bunch of cops? I mean, a lot of the times it's multiple cops and they're like, yeah, this guy ran at us with a knife. So you say, you could easily plant a knife there, put his fingerprints on it, there you go. And it's very disturbing. Not to mention the fact that, I mean, unless a cop is fired upon, I don't think they should be shooting anyway. They're supposed to be trained to deal with those type of situations. Now, a regular person to me is different because they're not trained to deal with those situations. If they're being attacked and they feel that their life is in danger, not by verbal attacks, but if somebody's actually, you know, attacking them, I believe that more leniency should go to an actual person than a cop. And it's the other way around. The cops just get away with whatever the fuck they want. But in this case, and Brad, I don't know if you got a chance to see the video, it was clearly blatant. And this was in Tulsa, Oklahoma. A man's car broke down. It was actually on his way home from community college. That's what they had said. And I believe he was also a preacher. But, I mean, not that that means anything. There's preachers who do a lot of bad things. But from the video, and I know they'll say, well, you don't know what happened before that. Well, it doesn't matter what happened before that because it's kind of irrelevant to what's going on. Nobody was in danger. He walked with his hands up and walked towards his car. He was at least 5 to 10 feet away from a gang of officers. It had to be at least five. And there's two videos. There's helicopter footage and footage of the, I think, dash cam. And this one of the cops, a female cop, shoots him. Another cop tased him. So, and why they even tased them, you know, and from the helicopter, you can hear what they're saying. And they said, oh, this guy looks bad. He looks scary or something like that. He looks like a bad dude. And I don't know what they're basing, you know, that on. This is actually one of the times where I usually look at things as, you know, when it comes to the police killing people, they do kill all races. They kill black people at a higher percentage. And I think that they look at a lot of black people as just because they're black, they're criminals. And I definitely think that happened in this case. I usually don't in a lot of cases. It all depends because I don't think that I think police departments, there's a lot of racism that goes on, but I don't think it's wanting to kill people, wanting to kill black people, racism. But, you know, and there's black cops who kill people too. So they're worse on black people, actually. That's what a lot of people have said. But I think this, it does kind of look like a case of, you know, possible racism, or at least that, you know, oh, this guy must be a criminal. So, Brad, I don't know if you had a chance to look at the video and if you have any thoughts on that or just thoughts on the issue with police killing people in general?
Sure, Dave. Yeah, I've got a couple points on that. I saw the video and it was really terrible. You can clearly see the man with his hands up, and you can see how the police think about individuals that they feel like they can control. And they feel like if you do anything that goes against their power, then you're going to pay the consequence. And it didn't even look like he was resisting arrest. And they tased him, and then they shot and killed him. You can see the blood pouring out of him while he's on the ground.
And the helicopter one especially, that one was pretty graphic, where you could see, you could see blood, like, all over him. It was bad. It's a mentality, and you see this in most of the police killings. It's the, you know, if you don't obey, we'll kill you. Just for the fact, it doesn't matter how stupid it is. If it's, well, you know, I tried to stop you because you jaywalked, you know, they'll kill people over that. I mean, as ridiculous as it sounds, it will end up, well, you disobeyed, so we thought you were dangerous, so we shot you in the back. And people may think, you know, I'm exaggerating, but it's to that point where cops believe that you obey them, you do whatever you want. Even in the beginning to the show, the song, the clip that I took was from a interview on MSNBC of a guy from the police union who essentially said, and I'm paraphrasing, but you could kind of hear it in there, you do what the police say, or, you know, we'll kill you. I mean, basically, it's what he pretty much said. If you end up dead because you didn't obey us, oh, fucking well. And some people even have that. And I can't, you know, believe you'll read comments now. I know that they have, whether it's, you know, FBI or just how they have it set up, government employees that they have, propagandists, we'll call them, that go to message boards and go all over the internet and post shit. And maybe they even have it automated, you know. So who knows how many of those are things like that, and how many are, you know, cops or relatives of cops or, you know, friends of cops or that sort of thing as well. But when I see comments like somebody said something, well, he disobeyed because we don't know what happened beforehand. He was walking to his car with his hands up and they followed him back to his car. But they had said something like, oh, he disobeyed a little female officer. Well, there were like five other guys with her. So like, what the fuck does that mean? They couldn't handle, you know. Plus, he didn't even do anything anyway. But, you know, there were like five officers there. So I don't know what the point was in their comment. But you even have, I had watched the video of the press conference. And it's, well, we don't know what happened. We don't have enough details yet to, you know, it's an ongoing. It's the same shit they always say. And you know why they don't know what happened yet, because it should take them. If a person gets murdered, usually, or a person kills a cop, they'll come out and say what happened, like, right then. If they'll say, we still have more, you know, it's still under investigation, but they'll give you so many more details. Now, if a cop kills a person, and I don't say citizen because there's no such thing, really, and it's just a bunch of bullshit, but we won't get into that the whole conversation. But so I say person. But they don't give you the details until at least 3 or 4 days later, because they're making up their fucking story of what happened. They're making sure everybody's on the same page.
Yeah.
So I don't know, Brad, if you have any other, you know, comments on that in general, or
Sure. Yeah, definitely, Dave. I've got kind of 2 points on that. I know somebody personally. I used to work with them at the bank, and her father was shot and killed by police officers. And he's an older white male, probably in his early 60s. It happened about 1 a.m. in the morning, and the police got a 911 call, and they went to the wrong house. I mean, we hear about this all the time.
Yep, it happened. And, it happened in June as well in Texas. Same thing. But sorry, yep. Go ahead.
No, no problem. Yeah, it happens a lot. And he came outside because he heard somebody drive up in his driveway. And so he comes outside with his gun. The police did not have their lights on. They didn't yell police or anything like that. So they creep up into the driveway with no lights on. They didn't announce themselves, and they shot him right in the neck. And they actually kept his wife inside the house while he bled to death outside. He actually didn't die on the driveway, but he died in the hospital like an hour or two later. But she was kept inside the house for like 3 hours and couldn't be by his side. And it was, they're trying to get their story straight, what happened. And it's a real tragedy when that does occur, because the cops are never brought to account. The cops, you know, I don't even think they got administrative leave because of it. And there's a lawsuit pending, of course, but again, the taxpayers pay that.
Yeah, exactly. That's one thing that does happen, that people usually get money. But again, you're right. You know, the police don't pay the money themselves. It doesn't even come out of their budget, and that doesn't bring the person back. But yeah, it's taxpayer money.
Exactly. And my second point is, I was at a pizza place, and I go there all the time with my older brother. And we were just hanging out talking about stuff, and a guy next to us was kind of, you know, adding into the conversation. It was about nothing really in particular. And I asked him what he did, and he said, I'm an Atlanta cop. And I said, oh, cool. Where do you work at? He said, in the hood. And I said, man, I bet that's tough. He said, no, I love it. He said, because you can push them around, you can say whatever you want, and you don't get in trouble. And he said, my buddy works in Buckhead, and his buddy almost got fired because he told a lady up in Buckhead, that's like the ritzy part of Atlanta, and he told a rich lady that he had pulled over to shut up, and she called his boss and his boss's boss and about got his buddy fired. And so when we hear about racism, when we hear about these things that cops do certain things to certain people, that's from somebody I had just met who told me that.
That must have been like a rich a person with connections or something, though, right? Because I never hear stories like that except from, you know, the very elite, because usually they can even get away with killing, you know, they get away with killing people with money and stuff like that. But maybe she had connections or something like that.
Political connections. I'm sure that's what it was.
That's probably why. It had to be, because, it's hard to get a cop fired, so... But yeah, I know what you're saying, that them saying that, well, over here we can get away with shit more, where they do try to target poorer communities in general.
Sure.
But at the same time, I mean,
they target everybody.
They're getting away with, you know, everything. And the story that you said, there was a story a couple months ago in Texas. The guy did have a gun, but it was on his own property. He heard something late at night, came outside with his gun because he was like, what the fuck? And he was a 75-year-old man, and the cop shot him and killed him.
Right.
So, and he was on his own property, you know, with his gun, because they went to the wrong house.
Mm-hmm.
So, and there's so many stories. It you know, you could sit here for like a month at least. And the only difference now is we have the internet and people have cameras and cell phones. If it wasn't for that, nobody'd know about it. I mean,
that's true.
This is something that's been going on forever. I mean, you look at Serbico, and I mean, that wasn't about people killing cops, cops killing people, but it was about corrupt cops. But sure. I'm sure cops have been killing people and getting away with it since the beginning of time. It's just go ahead.
The police in the South, they actually were created to catch slaves. And so that mentality, you know, has carried over to this day. And so in the North, the police force was actually created to protect the rich and to keep the streets and to keep the vagrants and the normal people from impeding on their night at the opera or protecting their factories from from vandalism or somebody stealing stuff. So the police have their roots in racism and their roots in oppressing and killing and beating people.
Well, it's in the protecting the elite, really, is in, in what it is. And then, you know, getting away with oppressing everybody else. But yeah, I mean, they definitely over the years oppressed black people way more than any other race. I mean, that's just a fact, especially in the South. I mean, then it's just ridiculous. But it's getting to a point now where they don't even not that I'm saying that they should act differently, because I don't care if they're just oppressing black people, I still have a problem with them. But they're oppressing everybody, no matter who it is. They don't care if you're an old woman. They'll fuck. I mean, there was an old woman who they, you know, talked back to a cop. It was on video, and he like grabbed her and handcuffed her, and it's just ridiculous. And it's really the mentality is you must obey. And we can't forget about, you know, the politicians, the judges, the prosecutors, all of them are a part of this. They're hiding because we don't really see them unless I saw them from, you know, going to court. But I mean, we see them, but not the same way. We don't interact with them unless you actually, you know, get arrested and go to court and stuff like that. But so a lot of people forget about them, but they're just as culpable. Mm-hmm. Just as culpable.
Oh, definitely.
The police are just their dogs that are taking orders. You know, sure. Go ahead.
And the politicians are the ones who are insulated from all of this. They pass the laws and they benefit and enrich themselves and their crony capitalist buddies, but they're insulated by so many different layers of federal, state, county, and city prosecutors, judges, and police officers that they never get the blowback, if you will, from their decisions that they make.
Yeah, they don't. And people are just blaming the police, which is well deserved. I mean, they should be blamed. They're going through with the actions. It's like Hitler's, you know, soldiers. They obeyed Hitler. They're just as culpable. I'm not saying don't blame the police. Blame the police, but don't forget about the blame on these fuckers too. Because they're just as bad, if not worse.
Mm-hmm.
So
definitely,
I want to move on because I definitely want to make sure that we have enough time. I know there's a lot of stuff I want to talk about with you. So Brad is a blogger. He has a few sites. They're listed in articles. They're listed on Facebook in the event. I had listed his sites, and I believe one was just a link directly to an article. But before you leave, we'll have you mention those again for the people that it will actually not just go in the event. It will be in the details in every archive will have it, because that's how it works. It posts all the information. So wherever you listen to the show, it will be in the details there, so you'll be able to find it. But before we go, we'll have you give those again. But before we get into that, and, you know, Brad has had some experiences that have to do with the medical system, some unfortunate and sad experiences, not saying that it's all because of the medical system, but had some things that happen, just really bad luck, I guess. Well, we'll get into that when we get to that point. But before we get to that, I wanted to talk to you because I ask everybody that, you know, believes in the ideas of what I call true freedom and liberty, not the conservatives that go around and say, oh, yeah, we believe in freedom and liberty. Yeah, but you think all drugs should be legal, so or illegal. So you obviously don't believe in self-ownership. So that's one of those questions that if you ask a conservative who calls himself like a conservatarian or a libertarian conservative or whatever fucking stupid name they use, ask them if they think drugs should be legal. And that right there tells you, if they say no, that they should be illegal, or some of them, it means right there they don't believe in self-ownership, first of all. And, you know, that's one of those questions that tell a lot to me about somebody. But what I like to ask people that believe in true freedom and liberty, because everybody has different stories and a lot of them are really interesting, and we're not in a society where the majority of people believe in these ideas. We're a small minority. I mean, it may be millions of people, but millions of people in a country of 200 or 320 million or something like that, is not a lot. So for you, I know you had originally been like a Republican Christian conservative.
Yeah, definitely. We weren't really raised in a churchy family, but we did go to Sunday school and we were Republicans. I listened to Rush Limbaugh all the time. I'm embarrassed to say I actually listened to Bill O'Reilly and Glenn Beck.
I had watched and listened to that. Even now, sometimes I listen to Glenn Beck, but not in the same way that I guess you were listening to them. I always listened because I hated them and I wanted to hear what they're going to say. Actually, I don't hate Glenn Beck now. He kind of seems like he truly wants freedom, sort of, in some weird way, but I don't know. But anyway, yeah, I listen because I want to see the bullshit they're going to say. And Bill O'Reilly, like, I can only take so much of him. I don't remember the last time I watched him. Sometimes I'd have to turn the TV off. But sorry, go ahead.
No, no problem. Yeah, so I was deep into that.
Sorry to interrupt. And you grew up, like, right outside Atlanta, about a half hour outside Atlanta as well. So you were in probably... I know Atlanta itself is like 60% black, but the rest of Georgia is, I would think, a conservative type, you know, area. Like where you were, was it, you know, were the majority of people there conservative, or was it mixed, or what was it like? At least, because this is a while ago too, when you were younger. So what was it like, at least at that time?
Sure, definitely. Well, anybody that we were around or associated with were conservatives, I would say. And a lot of times we didn't talk about it. It was mostly what the Democrats were doing, you know, with Bill Clinton and all his mess. And with that go around, you know, that's when I was really into listening to Rush Limbaugh. But Atlanta is very, like a lot of the big cities in the country, you know, is Democrat. And then the rural counties are definitely conservative Republicans. So that's how Georgia is mostly still.
Yeah. So are there any the only other city I know in Georgia, and this is because I'm into college football, is Athens, because University the Bulldogs are there. But there's other big cities in Georgia, right? Or
oh, sure, yeah, definitely Macon. That's Macon. About an hour and a half.
You know, I heard of Macon as well, because when I used to work, at a place where we used to send print newspapers and send them off like in bulk, and I think we would send them to. I would see Macon, Georgia, on there. So yeah, I heard of Macon, Georgia, as well. So you were conservative and all of that. And then, so at what point did you start to question that or start to find the ideas of freedom?
Sure. I think my path to becoming an agnostic and doubting the existence of God really flowed into or paralleled my discovery of the ideas of liberty as well.
Those seem to go together with a lot of people, to be honest, because it's questioning stuff. Like exactly. there's people I've talked to who have said they got into freedom first. They, you know, got away from religion and then got into freedom because it was a, you know, questioning type of thing where you're questioning, like, I've been taught this, but this is kind of bullshit. And then the same thing where then you start questioning, like, government and, like, well, you know, this is kind of bullshit, too.
Exactly. Yeah, the more you unravel what is, quote, unquote, authority in their message to individuals, the more that you have to question why you should be believing what they're telling you, whether it's in a 2,000-year-old book or whether it was written in 1776 or if it was passed by Congress today. You know, what is the philosophical ideas behind the words and actions of what people are doing? And my brothers, especially, and myself, we like to drill down to the bedrock of ideas and to see what's really going on. And that helped me to shed a lot of my beliefs about faith, religion, spirit, soul, and also about government, about the drug war, about taxation, and about living a free life. And you can be a good person. You can love other people without needing an intermediary, a gray-haired, bearded man in the sky watching over you all the time.
Right. And it's funny how, you know, the first thing that I think of, or one of the things I think of, and I thought of this a long time ago. I was never religious. Both my parents are two different religions. So I never believed in religion anyway and never really was brought up that way. Although my grandmother tried to shove Judaism down our throats. She wanted us to be Jews. But, I mean, I never, you know, got into the religion thing, probably for the same reason that I didn't get into the political parties thing. I questioned things at a very young age. I don't know if that was just it's in my DNA or what, because probably my father is, you know, was similar to that as well. But one of the things I was going to say is you always see the picture of the white Jesus, right, with blonde hair, but he comes from the Middle East. So
exactly
the black Muslims, they say Jesus was black. He wasn't black, but he was like, you know, like if you look at a Muslim or somebody from that part of the world, they're dark skinned and they have black hair and, you know, they're not white with blonde hair. But that's what they wanted to present. And that shows right there the whole illusion. It's just an example of the type of propaganda that comes out of religion, just like the type of propaganda that comes out of government. And just real quick, even Jefferson had written that, you know, despite what everybody thinks, most of the founding fathers were deists. They believed in some higher, like I would probably say I'm maybe a deist. I don't believe in a one God thing. I believe that maybe something exists that kind of brings the universe together, like a force or something. I don't know what the fuck it is. But I mean, that's kind of what a deist is, sort of. And Jefferson wrote that religion is just a means of control. And so did Franklin.
Yeah, definitely. And it's a way for a few people to prosper, enrich themselves while keeping the populace under control. And if you can tell somebody that they're going to hell, they'll do whatever you ask them to do, because nobody wants to rot in eternity being on fire and a devil, you know, poking you with a pitchfork for all eternity. So if you scare people with that story, then you have total control over them. And I think the 10% tithing is something that is insane if you think about how much is taxed from you. And then on top of that, you have preachers and priests taking another 10%. I think that's where a lot of the problems come in.
Yeah, it's very similar to government. And you remember, you probably remember in the 80s, Jim Baker and Tammy Faye with all the makeup, and they used to make fun of her on Saturday Night Live. But you had all these frauds that were ripping people off for money. And, you know,
and it's sad.
Yeah, it is. And right now, what they're trying to do, in a sense, is the government has gotten to a point where they want people to abandon religion, even though religion was that control for so long, because they want their God now to be the government. And you can kind of see that they're moving from, no, we don't want you to listen to religion, because a lot of religious people, although, are controlled via religion, that's their issue with the government, where their religion and the government, they take their religion over the government. So now now that the government doesn't have the same values and doesn't follow their principles, where a lot of principles, you know, came from like the Ten Commandments. But I mean, it came from just not because they were religious. They're just common sense, like, you know, don't kill anybody and, you know, shit like that. I mean, so now that there's a bigger gap between government and religion, especially in Christianity, the government doesn't want people to be religious anymore. They want them to worship the government.
Exactly. Yeah, that's definitely true. And it goes down all the way to, they don't want people to feed the homeless, that it's an act of rebellion.
It's illegal in most places.
To feed people who are starving to death. Yep. The government has obviously done nothing for, because they really don't care about any of us.
Well, they'll tell you, sorry, I don't mean to interrupt, but
no, it's fine.
I actually, I'm not friends with them anymore, but I was friends with somebody who actually, that's what he was doing, and he continues to do it. And the police they started arresting people. And then he got into cop block and stuff like that from that, because of him feeding the homeless and the police arresting people. And they told them to go get on welfare and food stamps.
Yeah, and that's really at the point where philosophy really matters. Ideas matter. What people believe matters. And when it comes to the government, they're based in the belief of force. And they want to control every part of everybody's life. That's their ultimate goal.
Right.
And they want you to work, give them all your money, everything that you've produced, and they'll decide who gets what in return.
Yep. No doubt. And it's funny that you say that, you know, that being their ultimate goal, because that's, you know, what I preach on the show is government's ultimate goal is to get to the point where they control every aspect of your life. And we see them going in that direction. We see them getting there. They're moving closer and closer to it. And people need to draw a line, because at some point, you can't just sit there and just let it happen. You know, and it's okay for people to say, well, yeah, if I was in Nazi Germany, I would have started killing soldiers. That's okay. And if you say anything about defending yourself against government agents, then it's like, oh my God, that person's a terrorist. That person, we got to watch him. We got to whatever. Mm-hmm. Why do they have the right? They have the right to do whatever they want in some people's minds. Because Larkin Rose, I don't know if you ever read or seen the video. And if you haven't, I'll forward it to you, of When to Shoot a Cop.
No, I've never seen that.
And the name got everybody. People didn't even read the article or listen to the video, and got mad just over the name. And you can go to YouTube to his channel as well. There's a lot of videos that he has that I think you totally agree with.
Just to be clear, Dave, if anybody's listening, I'm not advocating people go out and shoot.
Oh, right, right, right. I'm not neither. What I'm saying is, yeah, I know. You don't want cops showing up at your house later. No, but yeah, I mean, that was the name of the thing. And what it was about was just questioning, you know, talking about what happened in the Revolutionary War and saying, why do government agents get to do all this stuff to you that if a normal person did it, you would defend yourself. But because it's the government, it's okay. So it was really a conversation to say, you know, why, at what point, one, like, is it okay for the government to do like what Nazi Germany did and not do anything, and really just start the conversation? He wasn't advocating going out and killing cops or anything like that. Although, you know, I've said it on this show, and I'm not scared to say it, in self-defense, I have no problem with people killing government agents in self-defense. And I think for some reason, people automatically think that's wrong. Now, to just go out and randomly kill cops or anybody for that matter, because I think about the value of human life. And, sure, you know, I think is wrong. But no, he was, when you listen to it, you'll see, you'll understand his point and probably agree with it. But
okay.
People got I'll mad without reading, you know, they talked about it. And Glenn Beck was actually one of them. And they were demonizing him before they even read it just
their
by
reaction.
The name. You, right. Yeah. So, you know, it was really, though, talking about all of the governments where if these people were armed and fought back, it could have been different, like Mao and Stalin and Hitler and all of these people, and
sure,
really just bringing up that issue. But so I forgot where we started there, but
I think it was the government and religion. You know, when you start questioning, you really once you start pulling on that thread, it goes all the way down to the core idea, which you talk about all the time, and that's self-ownership. And
right,
that nobody owns you. Nobody is responsible for your behavior except you. And the government doesn't believe that. Those in government, the state, believes that they own everybody within their boundary.
Right.
And that
you were just born into it. It's like, so you were born in a certain geographical area. You somehow agree, not only agree to the current laws, but you automatically agree to the hundreds of thousands of laws, like since
sure,
you were born, that have been created. Never mind since you were born. If you count, say, your state, your county, your city, and federal laws that have been passed in the past year, I'm sure it's in the thousands.
And UN law as well that we're coming more and more under.
Yeah, the international law, which should not apply, period. But yeah, they have these treaties, these trade agreements that Obama's trying to fast track. They're not really trade agreements. A trade agreement is a page. They are, because I saw some of it leaked years ago of like the TPP, and I'm sure you're aware of all that. And, you know, it goes into, it's like 25 chapters, and it starts getting into really saying who's going to control what. Like, this country is going to control this industry. And there was a document, and I can actually send it to you, and it's on the UN website.
Sure.
It's something about, it was supposed to start in 2015, but sustainability or something 2015 and beyond. Anytime you hear sustainability is like a bad word. But
that's a red flag.
Yeah. It talks about richer countries giving money to poorer countries. You know, essentially it hints at world government. It talks about negative freedoms. So, positive freedoms as opposed to negative freedoms. So negative freedoms are the freedoms that we support, meaning freedoms that don't involve anybody else, like to own a gun, the right to defend yourself. I mean, that, I guess, involves somebody else, but it's somebody attacking you. The right to put stuff in your body. They have taught people that freedom, because I think this was in this document, too, something along these lines. But like freedom from getting killed. So guns have to be banned so you have the freedom to live. You don't really have the freedom to not accidentally die or for somebody to kill you. That is not a freedom. Or you don't have the right to free health care, because what that is you're saying that this person has to provide something for me. And you're not born with any right that involves anybody doing anything for you, except I'd say possibly your parents at least have a moral obligation to at least give you up for adoption if they're not going to take care of you. But, you know, that's more of a moral thing. And I would say you kind of do have an obligation, but that, I don't know, when you get to philosophy and you think about that, it gets a little whatever. But in general, we would probably say, yes, you have an obligation, you know, to your kids, but that's about it. And besides that, you don't have an obligation to buy them, you know, nice things or anything like that. You really just have an obligation to make sure that they're fed and that they have a place to live. Now, that's not being a good parent, but you don't really have an obligation to be a good parent. You should be a good parent, you know, but you don't have an obligation. So what I'm saying is, though, is that you don't have any rights that really require anybody else to do anything for you, again, except your parents, which is provide the minimal. But you don't have a right to get anything owed to you for free from anybody, not the government, not, you know, anybody else, because the government isn't really doing it anyway. They're like a pass through that enforces things through force. And even with in something we're going to talk about, health care, you don't have a right to health care, although I think there's a moral obligation there in a lot of circumstances. And you can definitely say that somebody is wrong if, like, a doctor sees somebody lying on the ground unconscious and just walks by, or really if anybody does for that matter. But I mean, for a doctor not to help somebody when they can, you know, they should, but really they don't owe you or anybody else anything. You know, they're a service, really. And
Dave, and you have no claim on another person's life, and they
that's what that is. Sorry, yep. You put it better than I did. That's basically what it is. It's a claim. Even something like free health care is really a claim on somebody else's life. And there's other examples as well. Like I said, they're saying you have the right to not be killed, so that's their rationale in banning guns. Or you have, those are called positive freedoms. I think I have it right. And the others are negative freedoms. Negative freedoms are positive things. So I think it's the reverse. They're things that are actual rights that you have as a human being. Or you could say, you know, they're from God or whatever you want to call it. You know, that's up to you. I call them human rights, but not in the same way that progressives call human rights. I call them human rights that you have as a person. When you're born, you are born with these rights. And really, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness are, you know, encompass all those things, I think, for the most part, although, you know,
and
when we get specific.
Property, yeah.
The right to own property, the right to self-defense, the right to put whatever you want in your body, the right to do whatever you want as long as you don't interfere with somebody else's freedom. You know, the same thing I say at the beginning of every show is that as long as, because if you're interfering with somebody else's freedom, if you attack somebody, that's infringing on their rights. That's the only way you infringe on their rights. If you attack them or do any damage to them that's not in self-defense or their property, you're infringing on their freedoms. Besides that, you have the right as a human being, regardless of what the government says. And the government's authority just comes from a bunch of men with guns. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's their authority. There's nothing that gives them authority. The people want to say, we the people give them authority. I didn't give them any fucking authority over me. They just took it. None of us were alive when the Constitution was written. And most of the people at that time were not involved in the process.
It was so bad that when the Constitution was written and they were trying to get it passed, that they didn't want to include the Bill of Rights. The anti-federalists, if you go back their papers, man, the anti-federalists had everything pegged about a standing army, about this new kind of aristocracy that was going to be built because of the Constitution, and the inherent evil of centralized power.
Because they wanted the power. I don't mean to interrupt, but that's why I say that government in itself is inherently evil and based on control. If you look up the definition of government, and I've said this before, it has control in it. It has the word control in it. So I believe when even the United States was started, it was started with the intention of, yeah, this is where we're going to start at. But in the end, they did it generationally. They did it over generations and generations because they started so far behind other countries, where they started with a certain amount of freedom, a level of freedom. I mean, even though I would never say the country, you were completely free, but there was a high level of freedom. And what the plan was, how I see it with any government, is to take total control, as we said, and control every aspect of your life. So it's taken them a lot longer because they had a lot more freedoms in the Constitution. So it's taken them a lot longer. And there's this thing, you know, over generations. And they did it a smart way. Because if a dictator comes to power, that's when it's obvious. And nobody can deny it. You know, right now, everybody lives in this illusion of freedom. And they're like, hey, my life's comfortable. I have my family, my kids, whatever. And I'm not saying me. I'm saying this is what the average person says. And I live a comfortable life, and I have, you know, a nice house and this and that and whatever. Why would I want to, you know, get the government mad at me and speak out or anything like that? You know, they're giving me this nice life, even though they're doing all this fucked up shit. You know, hey, I'm okay the way things are. I'm living comfortably. But they don't realize all the ways that it is affecting them, and that they are a slave, and all of these things. So the United States has done it in a way where that illusion of freedom causes most people not to want to fight back. And I don't mean literally fight, but, you know, stand up or speak out or do anything about it.
Reject the ideas of statism, of communism, of progressivism. Right. Or whatever ism that that people label it,
because it's not blatant in your face. Plus all the brainwashing that's been done from, you know, school media. I mean, you look at anything, and I think there's probably things that I don't even realize that are there. That's all part of the plan to brainwash you. But I want to get into, before we run out of time, and maybe if you can stay a little longer, I'll go a little later. I know you're 3 hours ahead, so I don't know how late you want to stay up there. But
it's okay. I don't sleep too much, so I usually a few hours at night and then maybe catch a nap during the day. So I'm good.
Okay. But so you had said when we talked off air that you're first kind of branching into liberty, and a lot of it came from you started reading. And I guess your brother had read Ayn Rand, and that's kind of where you started as far as reading into whether you want to call them libertarian philosophers or whatever. And you had started there and kind of just started reading all these different people. Do you want to talk a little about that?
Sure. Yeah, definitely, Dave. I think for me, it was definitely, I don't know, Ayn Rand. I think I say it wrong. I'm not sure. But Rand was a huge influence.
No, you say it right. I said it wrong. I called her Ayn.
Yeah. I'm not sure how to
it's,
say it.
You said things. It right. It's I can't even say it because it's A-Y-N. It's not Ann. I said Ann.
And it was Atlas Shrugged, but another book that she wrote called We the Living. It's about it's semi-autobiographical of her experience when the communists actually took over in 1917. And it's the story of this love story set within this tumultuous time where the family of this of the hero, the heroine, you know, they had her dad had a pharmacy and it got taken over by the government. They had this nice house and it got taken over. And then this commissar, they decided who stayed in what apartment. And you had no say of what you did. You had no say of who lived with you. You had no say basically what you had to eat. And that really stuck with me. And I also, well, I've got to say, give credit to Glenn Beck that he introduced me to The Road to Serfdom, written by Hayek.
Yeah, I heard him talk about that as well mm-hmm. as I think Alex Jones talk about that book as well. I haven't read it, but I heard them talk about it.
It's fantastic. And from The Road to Serfdom, I found the Mises Institute. That's M-I-S-E-S.
Yeah, I'm aware of them.
Mises.org. Yeah.
They have a bunch of classes, I think, the online classes that you can take, I think, as well.
They sure do. And they have tons of free books online. I worked at a bank. It was a community bank for a long time, and we were not very busy. And I actually read probably for an hour to 2 hours a day on the ideas of liberty, on sound money. I found Leonard Reed. He was the founder of the Foundation for Economic Education. And his philosophy, he put the freedom philosophy as simply anything peaceful. And that really stuck with me. And then I read Murray Rothbard. And I think he has one of the best grasps of the libertarian idea that I've really read.
Yeah, a lot of people mention him when they're talking about, you know, how they found the ideas of liberty. A lot of people mention, you know, Rothbard.
Mm-hmm, definitely. And then Frederick Bastiat, I think that's how you say it. He was a French guy.
Yeah, him and, too, I've heard people talk about him as well.
And I think he's the most accessible, him and Leonard Reed. If any listeners want to dive into the ideas of liberty, those two guys are they're not anarcho-capitalists, you know, they're very much grounded in pragmatism, but they still have the philosophical background of self-ownership, about how government is just basically the fiction that people compete with each other to steal from each other. They use it as a form of basically a gang to steal from their neighbors.
Yeah, well, that's what there's. I don't know if you ever heard of the School Sucks podcast with Brent. I'm friends with him on Facebook. I can't even remember his last name right now. At night, I go. That's why I get frustrated sometimes on the show, because after working all day, which is like mentally draining and depressing at this point. But I just forget all the shit. But anyway, he did I'll think of his name in a minute, or I'll look it up on Facebook and cheat. But he did a video where that's kind of exactly the premise, is that he goes from, you know, people robbing other people and organizing in the gangs, and then thinking of, wait a minute, we can just start, you know, a government and we can do all this legally. So it's like, hey, we're going to protect you, you know, starting from, well, you have all these other people that rob you and we'll protect you, but you got to give us this. It's basically the concept of a mafia, but that's kind of what he bases it off of. You'd have to hear it. I'm probably not doing it justice by explaining it, but I've played it a lot on the show, the audio, and it's great because, yeah, it ends with, you know, that's what the government became, was the criminals that went around robbing everybody. They're like, hey, we can legally do this by setting up a government and doing it that way and providing, you know, protection and, you know, all these other things by taking their money, but we're doing it legally now and calling ourselves a government.
Yeah, definitely. I agree, Dave. And another book that really changed my thinking was Our Enemy, the State, by Albert J. Nock. And his basic premise is that when the state, and the state, what I talk about when he talks about the state, that is the government, the bureaucracy, the politicians, and those who benefit from stealing taxes, basically. And when the state power grows, society, which he defines it as the free exchange of products and services between individuals, you know, basically how we interact with each other on a daily basis, without the use of force.
Not to interrupt, but mm-hmm. Brett Vanat. I'm sorry, Brett. I said Brent. Brett Vanat is the one who did that video. It's called like something libertarian. I'll have to give you the name of the video. Libertarianism is dangerous. Because he kind of starts it with the premise that he's no longer a libertarian. And it's just cool how he does the whole thing. But he also does the School Sucks podcast, which is pretty good. So I just want to make sure I gave his name and said it right, because I had complimented him on that a bunch of times. And he does it. He did a really good job on that. And it shows pretty good. He talks all about school, and he used to be a teacher, I think, and now he's a tutor. And so, sorry about that.
No problem. And that's what's great about living in today's society. I know that we talk about there are things that need to be addressed, especially the growth of government, but what individuals have done by simply cooperating with each other, by providing goods and services that people want and freely exchanging those for money and for other things, that this world has been created where we can connect to people through the internet, that we can talk to each other across the world. I mean, it's really miraculous, the technology that that we have at our fingertips.
Definitely. I mean, of course, there's the side where, you know, the government uses all this technology for evil, basically, is really what it is. But without the internet, we'd be fucked. And that's kind of why the government is going after the internet. I mean, Obama has said numerous times, I mean, you could type this into a search engine, you know, Obama having one password for the internet or something. Like, that's, he has been saying that since his presidency, that you'd have one password everywhere you go. So,
one ID, yeah,
exactly.
One ID, single
one ID, right. Is what I meant, what I thought in my head, but yeah, thanks for correcting me.
No problem.
Right, one ID, and they could suspend that, and it basically would totally suspend your internet access. They'd know everywhere you go, because you'd always have to use that ID. And They've tried a couple bills on the internet. They've also tried this thing with taxes where, you know, right now the law is you only have to pay tax in the state that you reside, where you have a physical location. So even if you don't have a physical business, the state that you live in would be, you know, that state. So besides that, like if I had a business where I sold whatever, I'd only charge people tax that live in Nevada, because I'd only have to pay tax in Nevada. But they wanted to tax every internet businesses in every state, and you'd have to file taxes in every state. And what if you had an issue with that state? I mean, it would be a total fucking mess. So basically, it would fuck with internet businesses, because think about filing in 50 states. Think about being under 50 different jurisdictions and all of this stuff. And they've done other stuff. They were going to pass other bills that would limit certain things in the internet. You know, they go after hate speech. There's so many different things that they want to do because they know that really the internet is probably the biggest enemy of the government in that it is used to spread all this information about them. You know, if it wasn't for the internet, I wouldn't be on right now. Not that I reach a lot of people, but not just me. All these other independent people like me that reach a lot more people that have the same ideas. I mean, it allows you or it allows anybody to go out there and voice their opinion and get these ideas out there. And that's a very important aspect of it. And I'm happy that I can go on here and anybody in the world. I mean, I know some countries will block, you know, the internet or certain pages or whatever. But for the most part, I'm an international radio, not star, but I'm I'm on international radio. Now, I don't reach, you know, the whole world. Although I've had listeners in other countries, but I mean, you know, I'm not huge or far from it. But there's that potential where I can reach people in other countries. I could spread freedom in other countries if I could somehow get them to listen to my show. So it gives you that power to reach anybody with all these ideas, or at least try. To reach, you know, as many people as possible with these ideas. And any, you know, shutting that down in any way is just bad, really bad for freedom. Because even with business, I mean, the internet is so free in so many different ways. And you have websites still, even though I don't know if you heard about Ross Ulbricht and the Silk Road site. Where basically he just, it's crazy, but all he did was provide a website that you could sell things that were illegal on. He wasn't selling them. He just provided a marketplace. So even things like that, people are doing on the internet and they're doing anonymously with things like Bitcoin and stuff like that. So the government doing things to fuck with the internet is, you know, like I said, there's been a bunch of bills. I don't know how much longer that we'll be able to have the internet as free as it is. And there was something that I heard of people building their own internet basically by just connecting directly to everybody, building a network by connecting to each other's computers where the government couldn't do shit about it. So there's other options there that people are working on. I think groups like Anonymous, although some of the things that they do are kind of, I don't know, they do some pranks and stuff like that, but some of the things they have done as far as getting information and releasing it, I think that is so important, and people that programmers and people that know how to do that stuff, hackers really, are really important in the fight for freedom because they're a threat to the government. And that's why they're going after these people. I think they killed one of them. There was a guy who supposedly committed suicide. However, if you, I saw a documentary on hackers and did a show on it because I think they're very important. If I was to go through the most important things, you know, legalization of drugs would be one of them. But hackers are a very important aspect because they could take down the government by, you know, hacking into certain things or releasing information or whatever. Not to go on, but just the internet is such a great thing, and we should be very thankful that we have it and that we're able to have the freedom that we have on it. Although, you know, they're tracking everything we do. There's ways around that, but it's getting less free as far as being anonymous if you want to. Although, you know, for me, it's like I do a show, so I'm already out there, so it doesn't really matter. But, you know, people that want to be anonymous, and, you know, it still is not, you know, okay for the government to collect the data of every site you've been to, every search you've made, and all of that stuff as well. So, I think we have an issue because I see your lips moving, but you might have muted yourself.
How about that, Dave?
Okay.
I think is that better? Yeah.
Did you mute yourself
by
accident?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Go ahead.
Think if there was no Julian Assange. Think if there was no WikiLeaks. Think if there was no Edward Snowden.
Yeah, and I actually saw the movie over the weekend.
What'd you think?
I thought it was good, but it didn't go into enough. I wanted a little more of what the government was doing to be present. I think it should have been a little longer and they should have gone a little more into the stuff they were doing. Oliver Stone in an interview actually on Glenn Beck's show had said that he didn't want to get too technical and confuse people, but I think they should have gone a little more into it. It shows it's bad. I mean, it has a scene where they go and actually tap into somebody's phone with the camera where they can, you know, they can go and turn the camera on your phone and view you.
Sure.
So mm-hmm. they do it to a Muslim woman who's taking off her burqa and they watch her, you know, undressing down to her underwear. And Snowden is like, you know, this is, you know, wrong. We shouldn't be watching this or, you know, whatever. But I think it could have gone more into what the government's doing. My fiance had mentioned when we were going to see it that she knew people at work who didn't even know anything about it. They didn't know that the government is spying on, because so everybody's clear, it's not, some people I think still think it's like metadata as well. And they think that the government did something or changed something. Yeah, they passed bill. Nothing changed. They take all of your data and store it. And then
Julian Assange actually said that Twitter is one long police interview that, you know, basically all your information is they're collecting just in case they want to use something against you later.
Exactly. And that's what I've been saying is that to be clear, they collect everything, store it in a database, and it's a big profile on you with all your data, everything you do, everywhere you go, your phone calls, your texts, all of that shit, regardless of what they try to say or deny or whatever. It goes to that point. Now, they don't look at everything because obviously they don't have the resources, but they do do keyword scans, and they have algorithms that run to look for certain things. Mm-hmm. So as the technology gets better, they're going to be going through this data automatically through certain algorithms to look for whatever patterns they want to look for. It's going to be like pre-crime, you know?
They're working on that. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, to identify based on all this information, they're going to put together a profile of you. And now they're doing in public schools, they have databases on kids and they collect all that information. So they're going to have a profile on you from the time you're born and through your whole life. And they're going to use that to predict not only behavior. I think in schools, they're going to use it to they're going to point people in directions and where they should go career-wise and all of that.
They do that, Dave. Yeah, they do that in China. They actually – you have a book on you from the day that you start and how you behave in the classroom. If your parents say anything about the government that's not that they don't like, or if you don't do your homework, or if you say something that they don't care for, then that's recorded and your teacher records that. And that's your record for the rest of your life.
Yeah. And that's what they have now.
Scary. And it's very scary.
But it's in a searchable database that's right. going to go together with all the other information as you go through your life, with not just what you do in school, but what you do outside of school, what you search on the internet, yeah. what you do, you know, anything that they can collect, any technology that you use. And of course, technology is going to increase both on their side and in the technology that we use. Just like, you know, people forget what it's like to be without a cell phone, but there's going to be newer and newer technology that people are going to want and that people are going to use that's going to be more evasive or invasive. I don't know if I got that right, but
invasive, you're right.
And yep. they're going to store that as well. I mean, it's also your what library books you check out, what you watch on TV. I mean, right. it's all yeah. of this shit. And for the purposes of, like what you said, that not only that they can use against you, but once they have, and they might have it already, the technology, they're going to build profiles on everybody. And they're mm-hmm. going to try to get to the point where they can predict what you're going to do before you do it. That's the ultimate. I mean, Google wants to be able to do that. Google right. and all of these other countries, companies, they were all started with CIA seed money. Because
they did, yeah.
And there's even a company that's a CIA front that's pretty big. I can't think of the name of it off the top of my head. But, yeah, because they wanted, you know, they want it for, like, military stuff as well. They want, like, military robots and all that. Right. That's like their number one thing is war, right? But
sure.
they also want it for, especially now with their war on terror, they want to be able to profile everybody. Because now it's, well, it could be anybody. Like this recent trash can bomb. Well, he didn't have any record or he wasn't on any list. So they want to establish, well, it could be anybody, and use that as a premise to totally profile people. And, you know, if you come up in that, you may be just targeted and watched, even if that's totally not something you would even be involved in. If it determines that, it's like, you know, they're going to watch you, or they may get to the point where those people are going to be in prison camps because you're on the, you know, or just totally eliminated like they were going to do in Captain America.
Exactly. That's what I was going to bring up, Dave, that you talked about that the other day. And just to give the listeners a statistic, they think that over 200 million people were killed by their own governments in the last century. So anybody who thinks that the progressives, the communists, the people who are in the government hate guns, that's not true. They're not anti-gun. They just don't want other people to have guns. They don't want the individuals to have guns. They want the military and police right. who they surround themselves with to have them.
Well, they're arming up. I mean, the police, yep. Government agencies all have at least a FBA. Division,
yeah.
if not yep. The whole agency has guns. So what was and we're talking about all this stuff that I'm sure, you know, affected you as when you first heard about them. But what would you say were the biggest, you know, and it doesn't have to be one thing. It could be a few things. The biggest things that got you to finally where you're at now to say, like, okay, basically, government is, you know, an extortionist mafia, essentially, you know,
right.
and to sure. get you to, you know, from reading these people And then I'm sure it was, you know, as you read and then you learn more and then you develop more ideas and read more and think more about it. And it's a progression. But what finally was like the last thing that you finally got to that point where you're like, okay, I this thing called government is not something, you know, and I don't know if you would say that you don't want a government or you don't, but like I say, I don't believe in government, but, you know, at least got you to the point where you're saying like, you know, government just wants to control, I mean, everybody's life and that's their purpose. And so what got you to that point that you're at now?
Sure. That's a great question, Dave. It was a few things. I think in 2008 with Ron Paul running for president, I read his book In the Fed. That was very influential on me. And also the book, The Creature from Jekyll Island, talking about the Federal Reserve and that there is a deep state, you know, underneath the government that we see, that the Federal Reserve, you know, 12 people or basically one person, they dictate what the price of money is, and that affects everybody on the planet.
Which is backed by nothing, and they print as much as they want when they want. I know they were doing like $80 billion a month. I think now it's like $60 billion. They're what's propping up the stock market right now.
Exactly.
If it wasn't for that's why, you know, the stock market does great, but people are still out of work and nothing's changed economically, really. I mean, it's gotten better since 2008, but I mean, it's still not a great economy. And that's why the stock market is doing good. But, you know, for the most part, not a lot of people, or there are still a lot of people that are in the same situations they were in, you know, 8 years ago.
Yeah, definitely. And I worked at a bank and I saw firsthand what loans do to people. As far as giving out loans and when people are under debt and they lose their job, you know, the pressure that puts people under, and how the Federal Reserve System is the bank for the United States, you know, the central bank. But there's central banks in all the countries around the world, and there's actually a central bank on top of all the other central banks called the Bank of International Settlement. They actually are the ones that coordinate all the other central banks in the world. And so there is this conspiracy of fact that there are people who sit in offices and they dictate what's going to happen in the world.
Well, also you got the, you know, the World Bank and the IMF as well.
Exactly. Yep, they're down the line, and then you have the UN.
And they just their loans to control countries, like they were going to do with Ukraine. They were going to lend the money under certain stipulations, which is control. It's, well, we'll lend you money, but we want this and this and this. And that's kind of, I read most of David Rockefeller's book, and I think I told you this off air, that he was one of the things that he did, and he might have been the first one to do this, because I think the idea of a central bank, although I believe they had one before the U.S. and other countries, but I'm not sure. But I think
the
spreading
Bank of England,
it, yeah.
Yeah, the Bank of England was, I think, the first one.
But spreading it through, like, South America and stuff like that, David Rockefeller started lending money to all of these countries. Like, so what he was in charge in was like foreign loans and stuff like that. And then he was running the bank at some point. I forget what bank it was, but it's like he wanted to get all these countries in debt, like indebted to the US, really is how I look at it. And, you know, I think it's the same thing where they want central banks in every country because it's a means of control. And like Iceland just finally said, fuck you, and kicked them out. But it was the bankers that really, you know, wanted to come into these countries. And they know that lending money gives them power over them. So I think it was a means of control as well.
Sure, definitely. I think it's an extension of colonialism, where it's not fashionable to go into countries and, you know, set up shop there anymore. So governments and the people who profit from wars and through inflation and through these other mechanisms of transferring wealth from one group to them, that's what they use now. They use the central banks to do it. And speaking of war, that was another, as far as my journey of individual liberty and believing in the freedom philosophy, it was Smedley Butler. I don't know if you're familiar with him.
Yeah, I know the story of Smedley Butler, uh-huh. where they went to him to overthrow the government.
Well, before that, he was involved in that. And before that, he wrote a pamphlet called War is a Racket. And my younger brother actually turned me on to that. And he was in the Marine Corps at the time. And Smedley Butler was the most decorated Marine up until World War II. He won, I think, 2 Medal of Honors. And so he was super highly decorated.
Yeah, I know that.
But he, what he did, he laid out how he was used around the world to benefit the Rockefellers and Standard Oil and Dole Plantation, that he made these third world countries safe for these people to come in and plunder the countries. And his take is, who benefits from that and who pays the price? He said the mothers, the sons that are bleeding to death, screaming out for their moms on the battlefield, they come back broken and battered. And these bankers and these the people who make the war equipment, they become millionaires and billionaires. And it's extremely powerful. If anybody is interested, it's War is a Racket by Smedley Butler. And the other was Lou Rockwell's site, lourockwell.com. He helped me finally break the idea that cops have any kind of special place in society, that they're merely individuals wearing a costume, that they should be, that they're under the same laws as everybody else, that they shouldn't be able to kidnap people, to shoot people indiscriminately. And that was another one of those dominoes to fall for me. And I'm grateful for Ron Paul, Lou Rockwell, and all those guys who've kind of paved the way for us.
Right. No, definitely. And, it's crazy how a lot of these ideas are suppressed to an extent. I mean, you have these guys that get them out there, but they don't get into the mainstream. Because I believe government controls media, and there's a lot of evidence of that in their own declassified
CIA
documents.
Yep.
Yeah, the CIA has interns at, you know, TV stations. I mean, it's pretty evident that government controls the media, among other things. And of course, you have the people that really run government compared to the people that are in office. And not that I think the people in office have no power, but I don't think they're really, when it comes to the big things and the main goals, that, you know, it's the people in office. I mean, it's the main goal is to, as we said, you know, to take over and have as much control as possible. And the people that don't subscribe to that, you know, either don't get elected because they rig elections, even state elections. I mean, they put money in. I'm sorry.
Yeah, they're dirty, Dave. I hate to interrupt you, but I've got a personal situation where I live in Henry County that I know the guy who was running for district attorney, and he pulled out of the race because George Soros personally gave his opponent $100,000 to run against him. And the guy who was running for office, Matt McCord, said in an interview that there was no way he was going to put his family through a Soros election cycle because of the mudslinging and all the dirty tricks that they use to discredit people and dig stuff up and make stuff up about families of people that they're running against. And so I've actually seen and, you know, had the globalist tentacles actually reach down as far as the level of a district attorney in Henry County, and George Soros, who I've heard about all my life, not all my life, but as I read about liberty and the ideas of liberty.
Years.
Yeah. And he's right in our backyard, and he's in everybody's backyard.
Yeah.
This
and
plan
it's
not just for us. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's not just him. It's you have money coming in to state elections, to Congress, to a state from all these outside people who have nothing, you know, don't live in the state, have nothing to do with it. So, you know, even things like governor, which, you know, isn't, or as you said, you know, you're even getting down to, and I believe the same thing in my county, in Clark County, Nevada, that they would never let the, because there's seven people on the Clark County Commission. So they would never let it get to a majority or under a majority that isn't going to support the things they want to support. And I looked at their budget, and they're basically run by the federal government because they're getting all this money for all this stuff. They get a lot of money from HUD, and it has to be very specific, like you have to do this. And that's how the federal government, one of the ways they're running the states, it's all money. It's one is they won't give you money if you don't do what they want. You know, they won't fund help fund education or help fund this or help fund that. And they put money into elections that really have nothing to do with them directly, meaning that they're not somebody who lives in the county or lives in the state, but they're funding candidates in these states, whether it's for, you know, a county election or a state election, to state, you know, legislature or, you know, whatever. So the federal government is now trying to control the states just as much as they're controlling, of course, the federal government. So it's, you know, there's nowhere to go. It's not like you ever had any say anyway, because you think about it, like how many votes are, if you take the smallest election, maybe if you live in a small town, but I mean, what is that really going to do anyway? But even in counties, I mean, you're talking about 50 to hundreds of thousands of people. So
yeah.
It doesn't mean shit.
It doesn't, Dave. And I think that only one federal election in the history of America was ever decided by one vote. And that was a long time ago, back when, you know, the country was extremely small. So it voting in a federal election is something that's not going to affect anything.
I mean, even voting, I think, like in county elections, you know, for the county commission here, I think there's got to be, you know, it's split up of a county of probably 2 million people, at least 2.5 million. So divide that by seven. I mean, it doesn't, you know, even the state assembly, you know, you got at least probably 40,000 people. In New Hampshire is, I think it's 3,000. They have 400 representatives for a small state. So that, you know, you probably could influence a local election in New Hampshire for the state. But same thing. I mean, if people want to bring money and then you got the political parties, but it is a lot different there. I will say that. But it's still, they talk about how free it is, but, you know, it can't be that free because drugs aren't legal. Gambling isn't legal. Prostitution isn't legal. Like, I look at Nevada, and to me, with the exception of the, you know, police, which are totally out of control, it's one of the freer states.
Mm-hmm.
But it's getting worse in this county, in the county of Las Vegas, Clark County. It's, you know, where it's probably getting worse everywhere, where, you know, the level of freedom is less and less. But Nevada is definitely up there when it comes to freedom. But that's just in comparison. It doesn't mean that we're that free neither, because we're not. But you know, there's levels of freedom. So compared to like California or Massachusetts or, you know, a lot of these states, you know, gun laws are almost non-existent, you know, besides federal, you know, things like that. So I'm glad I live in a freer state, but it's still not free.
Right.
So what I want to do now is we'll take a quick break and I'll play a clip from the AMA, which is very disturbing, actually, which has to do with the AMA and corruption and their documents. And then when we come back, we'll start getting into medical freedom and Brad's medical issue that he has and his experience with doctors and also the ability to, you know, be able to go out and get different medicines and the things they regulate and the pharmaceutical companies and those type of things. So we'll get into all that and more. Definitely check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com and read some of the articles on there. And you can find all our archives. There's so many places where we're at, but not every single show is there. But the one place you can find all our archives is actually Spreaker. So if you go to Spreaker.com, you can find every show I've ever done. Now, I don't know if I should be saying that because probably the first, 100 shows may not be that good. But definitely don't listen to show number one. That's all I got to say. So we'll be right back after this with guest Brad Miller, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
Do we learn from history? Sometimes we don't, as we're not aware of historical facts. This video reveals secrets discovered inside the hallowed halls of the American Medical Association. These secrets reveal a conspiracy that influences government and the choices available to us for our health.
I worked in intelligence for 15 years. Private intelligence. I worked for police departments doing undercover narcotics work. I worked for the FDA. They even hired me to go on a raid with them once.
I was an investigator back in 1968. I was hired by an unnamed client, which I prefer to keep sacred even 30 years later. The American Medical Association was conducting a series of I would say a yellow journalism, a sort of like a black propaganda campaign in the media against this alternative entity. And so they hired me to go to the AMA to find out. And my adventure started in November 1968, going to smaller medical facilities and associations, getting letters of introduction from one to the next, talking to the leading medical doctors of the day and getting them to give me letters of recommendation until I finally got to the American Medical Association. All of these people gave me letters of introduction under the guise that I was doing a book on quackery and health fraud. Actually, it wasn't called health fraud in those days. It was called quackery. I had set up an appointment with the head of the American Medical Association's Department of Investigation. His name was Doyle Taylor. He's not with us anymore. So when I got into the American Medical Association and Doyle Taylor gave me carte blanche to their files, I discovered a lot of things that I didn't know prior to going into that building. And so when Doyle Taylor told me I had carte blanche for 3 days, he just walked out of the office knowing that he was in good, you know, I was in good hands, and I was a good fellow. And it was on that basis that I was able to copy all of the documentation that proved there was a conspiracy against the client who had hired me. When I walked in the door, had I noticed cameras on the outside of the building, cameras in their marble lobby. I walked in April in Chicago, it's very cold, a nice strong wind at my back, through a revolving door, entered into this huge chamber, a foyer, that was probably 30-foot ceiling and all marble, and approached by a security guard and noticed more cameras. And now I've been in a State Department building. I've interviewed people in the CIA building in Washington, D.C. This was similar to that in terms of security. And so the first thing I thought was, my God, what are they hiding in this place? And within 3 days, I found out. The American Medical Association started this committee on quackery on January 3rd and 4th, 1963. And they assembled files on every form, everything you could imagine that had anything to do with alternative medicine. Every modality, treatment, service, product, manufacturer, clinic, individual practitioners, even patients, they had files on them. As a matter of fact, their files were so complete, and the federal government of the United States and Canada and Australia came down to the American Medical Association headquarters to do research on different practitioners and alternative entities. After I had seen these documents, and this was in April of 1969, I knew they had at least 100 file cabinets full of documents on all forms of competitors who were in the alternative field. And in looking at the files that they did give me and reading other people's files for 3 days, I realized there was a common denominator. And in doing investigations, you always look for a common denominator, one thread that is constantly there and brings everyone together because that's what they have in common. Well, everyone in that file room, although I never saw all of the files, didn't need to, everyone who were in the AMA's file cabinets had one thing in common. They were drugless healing arts. So now I realize, well, what we have here is drugless healing arts versus drug arts. I realized that they were committing crimes against federal laws in the United States that had to do with anti-competitive activity. They literally were conducting a campaign against all or any alternative entity that would threaten the medical status quo of orthodox medicine. When I saw this in the AMA about all these files they had, and you know what the two dichotomies were, I thought to myself, well, the greatest good for the greatest number, as far as I am concerned, is to expose this to the world, to let them know that the drug side of the picture is campaigning to destroy the drugless healing arts. And I said, well, the only way to do that is have some documentation. And the documentation I had was only for the client that hired me for this one job. And there were hundreds of people and entities in these files. So I thought, well, the best thing to do then would be to place somebody inside the AMA to work. And it doesn't matter how long it takes her to get to where she needs to be, but where she needs to be is in this file room here. Because when she's in the file room, anything she copies is totally okay because that's her job. And she takes work home at night to study it, fine. She wants to copy it to study it some more, fine. you know, 1970 and 71, for 2 years, this young woman, a brave young woman, went to work inside the AMA, and slowly these documents came out. Until one day I had a pile that high of documents that were really damaging to the American Medical Association. My focus was mental health quackery, and which encompassed, believe it or not, in the psychiatric world, mental health quackery encompasses religion and the belief in God. And that's a fact. Now, this is so important to understand. And it's been my experience. When it comes to governments, governments do not do, for the most part, anything on their own. They always, always, always have some vested interest, you know, someone outside of government urging them on to take action against that private individual's vested interest. Like the AMA has a vested interest in seeing that some herb companies close down. So they urge them to raid the herb company.
The whole medical profession was captured some years ago by the pharmaceutical industry. That's a shocking statement. It was literally captured, financially captured at the turn of the century when it was decided by certain people who had powerful financial interests in the pharmaceutical industry. It was decided that they would clean up the act, so to speak, of the medical profession. There was a study performed, it was called the Flexner Report. I think it was published in 1910, but it was begun, the initial research was done, I think, in 1905. And it was written by Abraham Flexner. Now, Flexner had powerful connections with the Carnegie Foundation and the Rockefellers. It turned out that Carnegie and the Rockefellers both had strong financial interests in the pharmaceutical industry. And he issued his report calling for all of these reforms in medical education in America. And it was a very good report. But what people didn't realize is that he was really being financed by the Carnegies and the Rockefellers. Why would they do that? Was it just because they were philanthropic and they wanted to help people? Or did they have some other motive in mind? Well, it turns out they really had some other agenda. The Flexner Report was published, and then there was a great hue and cry to bring about the reforms that they called for. Immediately, it was the Rockefeller Foundation and the Carnegie Fund that stepped forward and said, we will provide the money. We will be great benefactors. And they put millions up to those medical schools that they deemed to be worthy of their generosity. Well, how did they determine which universities, which medical schools would be worthy of their generosity? And the answer is those that were willing to institute heavy pharmaceutical courses into their universities, and those that would switch their training over heavy on research into drug research. Those that declined to do that did not receive the money, and they quickly fell by the wayside because they couldn't keep up with their competitors who were getting this transfusion of millions of dollars from the donors. If you look at any of the great medical centers in America, and I think this is true around the world as well, and you see where the money comes from to sustain these centers, you will see it comes primarily from the pharmaceutical industry. And as a result of that, the institutions are heavy in their training in favor of drug and drug therapy for just about everything. I don't care what you go to your doctor for, if it's a hangnail, a headache, even a broken bone. They're going to send you out of there with a prescription for something because that's what they have been trained to do. So this is how I can say a moment ago that the medical profession has been captured by the pharmaceutical industry.
What we discovered is that it was the American Medical Association, Doyle Taylor, who sat at the head of that table and directed the United States government agencies to take action against the targets that the American Medical Association, the Arthritis Association, the Rheumatism Foundation, and the American Cancer Society determined were threats to them and what they were doing. Right? All sorts of alternative cancer modalities, treatments, and services and products were targeted. Even the copper bracelet for arthritis was targeted. Books were targeted. Fred Stark's books, Adele Davis's books. You name it, they went after it. And it didn't matter what country, by the way, because the long tentacles of the AMA reached into Canada, reached into Australia, reached into Europe. And they spread their propaganda from their little file cabinet. So in 1975, there were documents from inside the American Medical Association that were leaked out by, let's call them friends of mine, to the media across the United States. The first one to receive it was a Garnet News syndicate, I believe, and Scripps Howard, I think, was the first in Garnet. And then big newspapers like the Washington Post, New York Times, and it just went all over the country. The leaking of these documents from the AMA, from inside the AMA, happened just at the time when the Nixon fiasco occurred and he was brought down by a insider in the Nixon administration who leaked documents to the press, and the press dubbed this person Deep Throat. So these documents were leaked from inside the American Medical Association on the tail end of that mentality. These documents started coming out from the AMA. And so instead of calling him Deep Throat, they called him Sore Throat. Okay, so basically, the American Medical Association dissolved, the Committee on Quackery and the Department of Investigation in 1975. Then in 1987, they lost a huge Federal Trade case where the federal government of the United States found and ruled that they were in violation of trade laws and anti-competitive activity, and they were guilty of basically conducting a conspiracy to destroy chiropractic.
My wife and I were doing public relations for entities having problems with government agencies. That was our specialty. That is definitely a specialty. It's called crisis management. We were very good at it, and we were based in California. Then one day we got our first health professional, and we were able to deal with that issue for them. We were dealing with people who were having problems when the government would come in and do things that were really unwarranted, like use bad publicity against the person to get them to cave in. Then we got another health professional, then another. And it wasn't too long before I had to take one of my clients to lunch and say to them, what's this alternative medicine thing? What is this? Because the term kept coming up. And that was the beginning of our education in alternative medicine. And I said to myself, this is America. This can't really be happening here. But it is happening. We got more and more clients involved in alternative health who are having problems with agencies. It's my belief, after careful research, that there is an organized suppression group here functioning in America and if not the world. And their purpose is to suppress new things that compete with drugs. And the apparatus is visible to a point. after the Wilk versus the AMA case was ended in 1987, the case that we all know was the chiropractors versus the American Medical Association, where the chiropractors were complaining about the AMA infringing on their rights to practice. The chiropractors won that case. The AMA was ordered to give up that covert operation, and they did. Shortly thereafter, several other groups popped up pretending to be consumer groups. In 1996, the Federation of States Medical Boards, along with the Quackbusters, I call them, hosted a convention in Chicago. It's infamous. Plenty of records about it. And at that convention, they characterized health fraud as alternative medicine. The whole focus of their presentation was to do exactly that. They tried to shift the definition of health fraud over to alternative medicine. And they had some success. The convention in 96, they made alliances. And then 1997, they had another convention with the Association of Attorney Generals. And they were training government people. The Federation of States Medical Boards has the contract with most medical boards to do several things. They do the licensing of MDs. They conduct the licensing exams. But they also were training investigators on how to investigate. They provided training classes. All over the country, there were events scheduled training people to believe, or at least supervisors and investigators, to believe that alternative medicine was health fraud.
The website for the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services includes the text of a speech by an FDA official to the Special Committee on Aging of the United States Senate on September 10, 2001. The FDA official cites Quackwatch, Inc. as their resource for health fraud.
This is so unreal to me that these people wield that kind of power that they could train government agencies on what a quack is, when they're working for the pharmaceutical industry's vested interest on going after the quacks because they're the economic competitors to the drug companies. So what happened after the leaks and sore throat and the $1 million fine and the IRS coming after them for $23 million, I mean, they were dying in the water. They were about to sink. This was a ship that was sinking at the time, and I probably should have torpedoed it, but it looked like it was sinking, so I walked away saying, great, we did it, you know, that's it. But it rose again from the dead. If you want to understand what's going on in the present, you have to know history. And if you can see that in today's economic competitive healthcare field, that the same thing is going on today that was going on in the 50s and 60s, 50 years ago, there's got to be something that's keeping it going. And in 1995, I took everything from the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and into the 90s, put it all together, took a year off, wrote my book, The Assault on Medical Freedom. There is an effort, a concerted effort, presently, and it will go on until it's stopped. And even when it's stopped, it'll probably rise again. Yeah, maybe not as strong as the first time, but it'll rise again. And, you know, it needs to be stopped. And the only way to stop it is to get the truth out, and I want to get the truth out. If you decide that you're going to do something about this, even if it's just talk about what you know now and spread the truth, then, you know, you're going to make a difference.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. We are here with our guest, Brad Miller, who is I would call him a freedom activist, but a blogger on his website, Healthier Today, and he has a legalized cannabis, Georgia.com site as well. So he focuses on medical freedom, but supports freedom in general, as if you listen to the past hour or past couple hours, actually, you can tell from that. But one of the reasons I think that Brad focuses on medical freedom and health and things like that is because of his own experience. Brad, would you agree with that? Is that...
Sure, definitely, Dave. Yeah, I come from the angle of individual freedom, but with a focus on the medical side because of my history. And also because when I was working at the bank and through taxation, when you don't feel well, when you're in chronic pain, you have chronic illnesses, and you see how much money the government is taking from you, yeah. And you're getting nothing in return, and they're taking money out for Social Security and for all these other things, which I don't even know if I'm going to be alive when I can collect on that.
Well, and hopefully, hopefully you will. But
definitely. But just the idea of them stealing my effort and my when you
well with
when
everybody
you work, it's
sorry
your time.
Not to interrupt, but with everybody, I mean, a lot of people die before the Social Security, just
sure.
You know, for whatever reasons, accidents, whatever. So yeah, I mean, there's a lot of money that they get from Social Security that really, in theory, they never spend, but of course they spend it all because they don't have it set aside in a fund. They just take it in and use it for whatever and put it with the rest of the fucking extortion money.
Exactly. And think about the federal government is $20 trillion in debt. So it's insane to think that they're taking the taxes from people when they're just printing, like you said, $60 billion a month. Out of thin air, but they still continue to tax us. But yep. With the medical freedom side, I'll just give you a little bit of my history. When I was 11, I was extremely sick, and my folks took me to the doctor, and my pediatrician's like, I can't do anything for him. So we went to the local the children's hospital in Atlanta.
On that real quick, just mm-hmm. to take a step back. So
sure.
When he said he can't do anything for you, like mm-hmm. what did he mean? Like, because the way you're saying it, that sounds bad. And there are doctors, you know, I had a weird chronic pain issue, and pretty much they didn't say that, but that's pretty much, yeah, what it came to. But was it out of,
it was
out
of concern.
Neglect out of the doctor, or was it just, look, I want to send you to this person.
Sure.
Was it the doctor was like, you know, I need to send you to this specialist because I'm not able to help you? Or was it just like, well, I don't know what the fuck this is, so whatever?
Yeah, he was a great doctor.
Okay, so.
He knew he was in over his head. I'm sorry. Yeah, I wasn't okay. Clear on that.
No, that's fine. I just didn't know. I mean, you will run into doctors that just really don't give a fuck. And they became doctors
sure.
because they thought they'd make money and
make a lot of money.
Get some girls and whatever. You know, who doesn't want to date a doctor? Oh, I'm dating a doctor. Because everybody
like
thinks.
Like Seinfeld, yeah.
Everybody
Elaine,
thinks.
She wanted to date a doctor, yeah.
Yeah, because they think they're rich or whatever. But. You know, not all doctors are rich, but yeah, I mean, there are those type of people that got into it for the money. So, and this, I know that was a while ago too. I think doctors have gotten worse. And I think part of that is because of the system. And a lot of the good doctors, I think, are getting out because they see what's going on. As we just played that clip with the AMA, and we'll talk a little later about the Affordable Care Act and how much that affects and restrains what doctors can do, and even with medication, with painkillers and whatever. So I'm sorry. So go ahead. So from that doctor, he sent you to somebody else.
No problem. Yeah. I went to a specialist, and then I was pretty sick for over a year with no diagnosis.
So what did when you went to the specialist, and what mm-hmm. kind of specialist was it?
Sure. It was a gastroenterologist for children, a pediatric gastroenterologist.
And what did he just did a whole bunch of tests and all this stuff and just couldn't.
It was actually a lady. Yeah. Oh, she was a great doctor. Yeah. But, she was really, she really cared. And she was back then, testing was really, not what it is today. There's been some amazing, advances.
Like 88 or something, 89 or.
Yeah, exactly. 88 to 89. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And they did tons of, they did like lower GIs, upper GIs, all kind of CAT scans and colonoscopies, and they knew something was wrong. They could see the inflammation, they could see the ulceration, they could see the narrowing and the swelling. But as far as a diagnosis goes, back then, ulcerative colitis and Crohn's and some other indeterminate colitis, they didn't even have really names for some of the stuff that we know about today.
Because if they would have figured it out earlier, would that have changed the outcome?
No.
That's
a good question, but they put me on the treatment right away. So the diagnosis was really more for the insurance company, I think, than it was for me. Because, the AMA is involved in all the coding and all of that. And I think we'll talk about that a little bit later, too.
Yeah, with Obamacare, how they totally added like 50,000 codes or something. But so from there, it was just they weren't quite sure, and they just did the test, and they started. What kind of treatment did they?
Sure. They started on drugs, of course. Yeah, like prednisone, like steroids, powerful steroids, which really I feel bad for anybody who has to be on steroids, because that really, really screws up your life. It just has some horrible side effects. And they put me on some other drugs at the time, which was standard treatment for ulcerative colitis, but I wasn't responding to any of it. So I was just getting sicker and sicker. I was throwing up, losing weight, not able to eat a lot. And,
Go ahead. So before that had happened, because I know you had told me you don't know the cause, and it's, I looked up some stuff and, one of the things they mentioned is genetics, but you had said there's just nobody in your family that ever had anything like that. Was it, at the time, you were a kid, so, did you have stress? Did you worry about things a lot? Did any of stuff like that, that could have contributed, or?
It's just hard to say, man. There's nothing I can really put my finger on.
I know it was a long time ago, too. But, because my brother, he didn't obviously have anything that serious, but he would get these horrible stomach pains when he was a kid, and they never could figure out why.
Sure.
And I think it was because it was he would worry about certain things or whatever. But of course, again, it was a totally, it wasn't anything where he had to have surgery or that serious, but he would get these horrible stomach pains. And I remember my mother taking him to the hospital and doing all these tests and whatever. But it's just, horrible that what happened. And I'll let you continue before I say, anything else.
Oh, no problem. No problem, Dave. I don't mind the questions.
Well, no, I want to make sure that I don't want to give away what happened, basically, before you say, what ended up happening. But
no problem.
Which was a terrible thing, especially for a kid to go through. It's bad enough, for an adult. But being that young, I'm sure that had an effect on you. But
it did, and my family, too. That's one thing, too, with with quote unquote health care, you know, it affects the entire family.
Yeah.
And it's not just the individual that's suffering. The entire family suffers. And the way the medical system is set up, it's really to treat symptoms and diseases. And it doesn't focus on health at all, actually. It focuses on diseases and symptoms. But to go back
to... it's like the police. It would be an analogy, mm-hmm. like, you know, yeah. the police don't protect That's people. Right. They don't keep them safe. They're there to really to control people, teach them discipline, put them in jail, and collect money for the state. I mean, they're there to enforce laws. And now, I guess it's in their name, but supposedly, oh, yeah, people say they're there to keep you safe and protect you, but they're not. And it's almost the same thing. It's a similar analogy with doctors where, you know, what they're there for or what they should be able to be there for and what they're actually the reality of it.
And I don't want to paint too broad a brush here because I've had some excellent doctors.
No, I'm sure they're
fantastic and really cared about, you know, my situation, well, but they're inside a system that is you know, definitely profit driven, which I have no problem right. with at all.
But it's controlled. It's too controlled by, you know, it wasn't as controlled sure. back then, but it still was controlled by, you know, insurance companies right. and it still is now. And, you know, Ron Paul was a doctor, as you know.
Sure.
And, you know, I remember him saying something about, you know, like the 60s or something like that. Like people didn't need to used to have insurance. Because
right.
you didn't have
exactly.
to go to the doctors. You could afford all this stuff. And somewhere, and I haven't done enough research to know, but I would blame it on the government, to be honest, because I'm sure certain regulations and certain shit that they put in, you know, an aspirin is like $20 at a hospital. It's just
yep.
they fucked everything up. And I don't know, again, enough to say what happened that they got things to where they are now because they weren't like that before. Just like
exactly right.
Just like you know, people in the 1960s, you could have one job, you know, be married and have a family with one job and have a house and a car, and you can't anymore. You know, the
sure.
government has fucked up everything. Everything they come across, they fuck up. So I'm sorry. Go back to your
No problem. I totally agree, Dave. And it's funny how the more government fucks everything up, the more people accept the government in their lives.
Yeah,
and
it's a weird thing.
It is the craziest thing that the more they screw up, the people complain about the roads, they complain about traffic, they complain about government schools, they complain about all of this. But at the same time, they're always asking for government to take care of their retirement, their health care.
They can't see. They got blinders on. They don't realize
yep.
that there's other options.
Exactly.
It's just like people that protest the police that are progressives. You know,
mm-hmm.
you're protesting the police, then you're asking for more laws. You're contradicting yourself. Because if you want more laws, you're going to get more abuse from the police.
And they want to be the ones, I think what that boils down to, Dave, is that people are jockeying for control of who points the gun at whom. That they want to be the ones that benefit from the taxation system. They want to be the ones to benefit from, you know, robbing your neighbor to dole out to their crony friends and to their non-governmental agencies and all of that other stuff that goes along with it.
So after that year, I guess, and I'm sure that was a horrible year for you. And, you know, at that age, that's when, you know, it's not as bad as if you were like 6 or 5, but you still
right.
are at an impressionable age where things that happen to you can have an effect on you for the rest of your life. And, you know, from talking with you, you know, I don't know you that well. We've talked, you know, for a couple hours, whatever. But you seem like a positive person and a lot more positive than I would. You're a lot more positive than me just in general. And I don't have you know, the issues. I don't have any traumatic thing like that. I mean, I've had some fucked up things happen to me, but I mean, I think about something like that, and I don't know how I move forward with my life, to be honest. I don't know, and I don't want to say this in a negative way, but like I'd feel like I wouldn't want to live anymore, to be honest. I'm not saying that. I hope that doesn't come off bad, but I'm just, you know, thinking about it, and I'm like, you know, with me, and maybe I'm being overly, you know, dramatic or whatever, but for me, I'd be like, I don't know if I can go on from this, you know? And
sure,
I give you a lot of credit for, you know, you're doing positive things. You went on, you know, obviously with your life and lived as normal as possible. It sounds from what I know up to this point, you know, just like anybody else. So I give you a lot of credit for that. So after that year, going to what happened?
Sure. I had surgery, and we had the surgery done by the top surgeon at the top children's hospital in the Southeast. And he actually lied about his credentials, and he lied about his training, and the surgery didn't go well. And it was, you know, it had some really horrible repercussions that I'm still feeling today from that surgery, you know, back in 1989.
Wasn't there, you had said that they like messed up on something?
They did.
Was
yeah,
it medical malpractice? Were you able to get some money out of that?
I really can't really go into the details about that. But yeah, that's a whole different story, and I'll probably tell you that one off
okay,
air.
That's fine.
A very interesting one. But I had another doctor who was a colon and rectal surgeon who took over my case, and he, and in the meantime, you know, I almost died once because they gave me the wrong fluid. They put me in the hospital.
Jesus.
I almost stopped breathing. They had to put a tube down my throat. And all of these different things added up. One time I had surgery, and they couldn't give me any pain medicine afterwards, and because my heart and my lungs weren't strong enough to take it. And so I can remember laying in the ICU, you know, basically just being in horrific pain. And you know, those type of events, you start to see that authority isn't authority; that it's an illusion. These people who say they're omnipotent. They say that they understand you, that they understand what you're going through, that they have the authority to tell you what you can and can't do. You know, over the years and all the things I've been through, it's really, you know, come to the conclusion that nobody has a fucking idea.
Yeah, it's like, fuck you. I got to go. Yeah. You don't own my fucking body. You're going to tell
me
what I can't do. I suffered through all this shit. Like, if you wanted to fucking do heroin, go to fucking do heroin. You know, I'm not saying go do, but you know what I mean? You go through all this shit, and then the government, you know, would throw you in jail because, you know, say you didn't have the attitude that you had, and you became a big drug addict, you know, and who would blame you? You know, seriously,
right.
I wouldn't blame you. You became a heroin addict and started shooting heroin. And then the government's going to throw you in jail and then treat you like a criminal and treat you like shit. I mean, I was in jail for 2.5 days, like I said, waiting to get bailed out. And then even just being processed, it took a day.
That's gotta be awful.
Yeah, it's horrible. And this is just county jail.
Humanizing.
Yeah, they try to treat you like you're some criminal. And it was for obstruction of a police officer. It was bullshit charge. And I had bruises all over me, and that's a whole nother story that I told on the show, so I don't need to go into that, but, you know, and they treat me like I'm nothing, you know, I fucking accomplished all this shit on my own. I got, you know, my bachelor's degree in film, I got a master's degree, not that that makes me any better than anybody else, but I mean, I accomplished stuff that, you know, I never had any support from people, you know, I got to live with my parents, that was about it, but, you know, my father, you know, whatever. And it's not like I had encouraging parents telling me, you know, whatever. And I had to get all loans. I didn't come from, you know, a wealthy family. We didn't live in poverty, but I mean, we, you know, we got by. But point being that, you know, I have these people fucking degrading me. Like, who are they somehow better than me because some cop wanted to arrest me because I questioned him on why he was asking me to get out of my car, you know? And I think about, like, what I said, they would take you and treat you like shit because you had a tough life and fucking turned to drugs to deal with it. Now, that's not what happened, but if that is what happened, you know, what the fuck? You shouldn't be in a jail.
That's exactly right, Dave. And they've done studies with, there's this guy who's helping women in Toronto. It's a like a rehab type place, but it's like an emergency place where people can go and to get help who are hooked on heroin. And he said every woman that's come in there who's been hooked on heroin is has been raped, molested, and, you know, beaten. And what people need to realize is that when people are using drugs, they call them quote unquote illegal drugs or whatever, is that they're trying to self-medicate because of some trauma that's happened in the past. And to treat those people like criminals instead of having compassion for them is where I think a lot of conservatives and a lot of progressives and all these people who say they care for people, but they truly don't because they haven't lived through it. They have no idea. No, they have no empathy, you know, for other people. And it's really, it is criminal. Yeah,
it's fucked up
to be treated
and
that way.
And it's, as I mentioned off here too, I mean, there are also functional drug addicts as well that, you know, they might be self-medicating, but they may actually really need something, and that's what they choose to use because they don't want to deal with doctors or whatever. And if it doesn't affect their life, who gives a fuck? Leave them alone. You know, if it affects their life, because really, somebody that's a drug addict is usually doing it for, well, basically what you said, self-medication. But there's an underlying issue, unless you know, and the underlying issue may be pain too. But you know,
exactly, emotional or physical pain.
Right,
it's the same thing in the body. Yeah.
But it was so. I mean, in a pain is fine, but it may be for, like you said, emotional pain. They may be trying to cope. The issue is not the drug, and that's the whole thing. They think if they stop using a drug, they're fine. No, they have emotional issues that they need to deal with. If that's the, you know, if they're a straight up addict where it's fucking with their life. Some people might be bored and be recreational users and they can deal with it, or functional users. And they're like, well, you know, fuck, I'm bored. My life isn't that great. So whatever, but whatever the reason is, that's their right. And as you were saying, I mean, you're going through all this shit that you didn't even have a choice in. Not to say that you wouldn't have done the same thing, but because you were only 12, it's you didn't even have any choice in what happened to you. And I think at that age, to be honest, I mean, you know, when you're maybe, you know, 5, 6, 7, no. But even, you know, by age 10, I don't know, it's hard to say, but by age 12, I mean, you're old enough to, I think, you know, at least have the majority of input on those decisions. I mean,
well, it was, Dave, I was so sick that...
No, I understand. I'm not really saying maybe your case specifically, but just
that's a really hard
in
thing,
general,
you know,
with
illness and... because you almost really need like a third party. I've been thinking about this a lot lately because when you have like a family, my mom's always been with me. She stayed through every hospital stay, even last year when I was, or this year when I was in the hospital, she was there. But you almost need like a third party advocate for you while you're laying in that hospital bed and filtering what they're saying to you and filtering what your desires are to them.
Because no, and that's fine,
and
but
it's pretty crazy. It's nuts when you're stuck in the hospital, and it's similar to jail because they do dehumanize you.
Yeah,
because you're in a gown and you know you're very vulnerable.
Can't leave in certain circumstances. You know? you know, where you're kept in a hospital where they won't let you leave.
Yeah.
And things like that. So, yeah, I mean, I just think, you know, it comes down to, you know, the same thing where self-ownership and, you know, kids really get screwed over when it comes to that. I really.
It's really hard. Yeah.
You know, and
it's a hard one.
I don't know at what age, because I don't honestly, and I've talked about this, I believe in peaceful parenting. And I don't believe if I have kids, I'm not going to discipline my kids. I'm just not, because I don't believe in authoritarianism. And basically, people bring up their kids to become a kid, the government becomes their parent. And, you know, I don't know how I deal with, you know, when they're 1 and 2 and 3, it's easier because they're not, you know, what are they doing that you're, you know, you just pick them up and whatever. But, you know, when they get to they're consciously aware of what they're doing and what's going on. I mean, for the most part, you know, I don't believe in telling them what to do and disciplining them. I believe in being. You have to be, I think, go even further than parents do and be there all the time. But you got to be there all the time as an advisor, I think, as a, you know, your kid gets build that trust. So they'll just listen to you. You won't have to make them do anything. And I don't think you should make them do anything, really, for the most part. But it's just kids really get screwed over, especially teenagers, because, you know, at least by high school, like, okay, you went through, got to this far. You know, I really think that high school kids get screwed over when it comes to making their own decisions and how parents act like they own their kids. But I don't want to get into a big wrong conversation on that. But so that really is my only point. Of course, you know, I wasn't there and what you went through. My only point was just that, you know, along with everything else, I don't know if you felt this way, but it was like everything's being dictated to you, kind of.
Well, I did, but I did have say, like, I've been to some doctors and I've hated them, you know, and I'm like, I'm never going back to those people again, or that doctor's never going to touch me again. I had one doctor, which I've actually recanted this, but at the time I was laid up and my veins are so terrible that it usually takes like 10 to 12 sticks to get an IV in me. And I was just doing so poorly that my IVs were blown out, and he decided to put a central line in my chest while I was still awake. It's at the neck area that they go in, and he didn't give me enough numbing medicine or anything, and I could feel him scraping and cutting through my skin. And, you know, after that was over, I told him, you'll never touch me again. But now he's my doctor and I really like him. But at the time, you know, I had the say to do that. So I did have input, but at the same time, you know, you're just in this really shitty situation where you're just trying to survive a lot of the time.
Yeah. Well, I was saying when you were a kid, you know, of course, I know now, you know, you have obviously say, but, you know, like there was, there's been stories where, you know, kids were forced to undergo things, you know, that they didn't want to do, and parents, you know, forced them to do it. And I think they might have even went to court over it and stuff like that. So I'm not saying that was the case in your situation, but I mean, that does happen as well.
And Dave, there's the other side of that too. I've read stories where I've had probably about 50 small bowel obstructions, which are extremely painful, like laying on the floor, crying, screaming, painful. And, you know, I've read stories where this one family allowed their 70-year-old to die from a bowel obstruction. Their intestine exploded and they died at home because they didn't believe in medical treatment. So,
yeah,
you know,
I've heard about those too. Yeah,
that's
usually
thing,
the religious,
you know? Exactly.
Loons
it was a religion,
that, yeah,
Christian
they don't,
science. I don't know what that was, but it was crazy.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, definitely. But yeah, that's a hard thing.
Christian
man.
Science. It's the people that make the Christian Science Monitor.
That's right. There you go. That's it.
You were kind of mixing Christian Science with Scientology.
Yeah, that's what I was doing. Yeah, they're both all fucked up, right?
Yeah. So how much does it affect you today? So this is something that, you know, that happened and then it just continued to bother you just since.
Yeah, the way it works, I won't get too graphic, but when they removed my colon, they did a temporary ileostomy, they call it, and they tried to hook me back up so I'd be normal as far as my intestines go. But that, because the first doctor screwed me up, it screwed me up forever because of that. And so at 16, you know, I got a permanent ileostomy. That's where the small intestine comes out the side of the stomach, and that's how I go to the bathroom. So I have a permanent, you know, I have to wear a bag all the time. So it definitely has affected my entire life.
Yeah.
And because of all the surgeries.
So if it wasn't for that doctor fucking up, then they would have been able to normally
hook me back up where I could function normally. Yeah.
I think
there's a possibility, but you just never know. It's not 100%, but I had a better chance.
Because I think that's what happened. I told you off here, one of my ex-girlfriends, her niece had something, I believe she had something similar where she had her intestine removed, she might have not had her whole intestine removed, but she was able to function normally after her operation. But she did have some of her intestine removed, and I don't know if it was the same thing. I think it was, but maybe it wasn't as serious, or, you know, now also this was more recent, as she's 18, and it was when she was younger, but, you know, is still, I don't know what the technology is, you know, in the past 10 years it would probably happen. So it may be also that there's better technology to handle things like that.
Sure. Surgery has improved. I mean, just like any technology and just people doing something more and more, you know, they're going to innovate. And that's the great thing about freedom is that the more freedom you have, the more experiments that you can do in that, because every individual is so different. My life experience, your life experience, but we can both agree on the ideas of freedom and that we need to be able to be free to experiment in our own lives, to live our life to the fullest and to really make sure our potential is fulfilled and that we have an opportunity to test out all these other different ideas about what we want to do for a living, what we want to ingest, how we want to feel, who we want to be around.
That's the whole thing with freedom is I don't want to tell somebody how to live their life. That's
exactly
the whole idea.
Yep.
Whatever that values you have or whatever things you want to do or how you want to live, as long as you don't tell other people to live the same way, you know, within reason, if you're like, well, I like to kill people but that would be, you know, as long as you don't violate what I said, you know, the not harming anybody else or whatever, you know, but you want to live your, you know, conservative, say when it comes to girls or something or whatever, you know, not conservative politically, but, you know, or conservative when it comes to sex or something. You don't want to, you know, some people are very whatever. I had a friend who, you know, liked to watch people have sex with his wife. It's just it's not my thing. But hey, if he likes to do that, that's fine. You know,
exactly.
Some people are big porn addicts. I'm not really a big into porn, you know, but not to say I've never seen it, but. You know, but if you are, that's fine. That's the whole point. It's not about, you know, people having to live their lives the same way. It's just about having the freedom to you live your life your way. I live my life my way. Everybody lives their life the way that they want, and they have the freedom to do that.
Definitely.
And that's really the whole point, but, you know, of course, the government sees it very differently.
They do, Dave. And my school, you know, going to school was a big eye opener for me too, because in middle school, I missed most of middle school, most of high school, due to being sick. But the teachers, the way that they would treat me was just horrible. That I did not fit in their little box, you know, like that's something that I think has led me also to the freedom angle, is because I didn't fit inside their preconceived idea of what a student was, or a preconceived idea of what you should be doing this. You should be attending school at this time, blah, 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 blah. Right.
What's the one size fits all model that you put everybody into? Yeah, because it's all trying to make everybody equal. And you know, we talked about the and I've done shows on it and brought it up so many times about how the model of public schools in America, which was first started in Massachusetts and with Horace Mann, but it was based on the Prussian model, which was to have obedient soldiers and to have people that agreed with the king. And, you know, it was all about indoctrination and teaching people to be obedient. And that's the whole point. And if you break down school, and I we won't get into too much detail now, but, you know, none of it really makes sense in how it's structured. And it makes sense if, like you said, you know, you want to the communism and to have everything uniform, basically, and it even in structure. And you know what? I forgot to bring this up, and I don't even know if I brought it up on the show. I think I did when I did a show on this. John Taylor Gatto had said this. So I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Stand and Deliver. With Edward J. Olmos and Lou Diamond Phillips. Well, it's about in California, I think in the L.A. area, it's mainly a Mexican area. And the teacher, Edward J., you know who Edward James Olmos is, right? The actor who's, I don't know if he's Mexican. He's Hispanic. I think he's Mexican. But anyway, and Lou Diamond Phillips, who can pass for Mexican, but he's actually like Filipino and Native American or something. Anyway, you know Lou Diamond Phillips, right, from La Bamba,
yeah.
Where he played, he was always playing Mexicans, but he's actually not Mexican. Kind of like Robert De Niro, he's actually like a tenth Italian or something, and always plays Italians. But anyway, so he taught this group of kind of, they weren't fuck-ups, but they were like in remedial math, basically, to pass the college AP calculus exam. And what John Taylor Gatto said, and I don't know if you've heard of him, but he was a teacher and he's done all these videos about, you know, how fucked up, you know, government schools are and that they shouldn't exist and all this stuff. But he had said that they even teach you. He didn't come out and say it this way, but he used the example. It was the way he had taught them. And even in the movie, they questioned them. And it's based on a true story. What they did was, I don't know if this part was true, but they had, got all the same answers wrong. So they thought they cheated. And he said it was because the way they taught them. So what John Taylor Gatto was saying essentially is the way they teach people, they purposely teach them in a way to dumb them down. They don't teach them in a way to educate them.
They don't teach people how to think. That's one thing that the school system is not meant to do.
So, yeah, I mean, that's... it's set up that way, but I know we're running out of time. So I know there's things that you wanted to address regarding medical freedom. So
sure.
I definitely want to give you the opportunity to just speak upon that in general and any specific topics that or ideas that you want to bring up.
Sure. Thanks, Dave. And I appreciate being on the show, man. And I'm a huge fan. And I really like how you always break it down to self-ownership and the non-aggression principle, which is just simply that nobody has a right to initiate violence against somebody else. And anytime we talk about government and laws and regulations, that is an initiation of violence against individuals, because if you violate that law, then, and if you continue to, or if you resist, then like you talk about, you know, the government will come and get you. And if you resist that, then they will shoot you. But as far as medical freedom goes, you know, my life story, it's, you know, been a struggle. Everybody's got their own struggle. But with medical freedom, I'll preface it that way. I do not need the government in between myself and the providers of goods and services that are in the healthcare field. I just don't need that. I don't need somebody telling my doctor what they should or shouldn't be prescribing me. I've had run-ins with doctors having trouble with the DEA. I mean, to think that physicians have a DEA number and they track every one of those prescriptions that they write is tantamount to the KGB monitoring what people are watching on TV. It's really insane to think that you have an unchecked bureaucracy who has nothing to do with your health care is monitoring what medicine that you're taking. And this extends to now that with pain medicine in the state of Georgia, and I think it's like this in most places, is that pharmacists and doctors are required to enter into a database, you know, pain prescriptions now, so that there's some shadowy government agency, which I never voted for. I have no idea where it is, but has my information that I never gave them permission to have. And I believe that's a violation of your right to privacy. How is that not? I do not need a caretaker who sits behind an office and produces nothing of value, and all they do is siphon off money from the productive side of society. And with medical freedom, what I talked about on my blog is, excuse me, is that I do not want others to commoditize my suffering and act like they're actually helping me, when what they're doing is using the force of government to enrich themselves and increase their power sphere. And the pharmaceutical companies do that. The AMA does that. The hospitals do that. And the government
even the pharmacies
does that.
There's a video as well that is disturbing that shows it's for, I think it's from the federal government. It was shown in California, but it shows pharmacists what to look for. That pharmacists are supposed to be looking out for people that may be trying to get a bunch of pills to sell them, or that are suspicious or whatever. I should find the video. It's fucking disturbing. It's a YouTube video, so I could probably send you the link. But yeah, it goes through the pharmacy, and then it has examples of all these customers. And they have that now. I mean, it's fucking ridiculous. And you had a guy in Nevada here that was going after doctors. He's like, he was trying to submit bills in the state legislature and trying to go after doctors and, you know, arrest them. So doctors now, and I don't know if this is something you want to get into in the time we have left, but doctors now, between the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare. It's funny. There were some people who thought it was two different things. They did a video where a guy was going out, you know, when he said Obamacare, they had a different answer than the Affordable Care Act, but it's the same thing. But
that's crazy.
Between that and the government, between that bill, which is the government, but I mean, and the DEA and all of that, I mean, a lot of doctors don't even want to be doctors anymore. They're getting out of the medical industry. So I don't know if you want to go a little into that and then maybe talk about cannabis, because I know that's something that you're trying to help get legalized in Georgia with your – you have a website there as well, legalizedcannabisingeorgia.com.
Yeah, definitely, Dave. Yeah, with the few minutes we have left, you know, I've been in and out of hospitals for the last 30 years. I still have adhesions that cause horrible pain on a daily basis. I still have the threat of small bowel obstructions every day. And I have chronic pancreatitis, which is one of the most painful conditions that's out there. And I still get, the DEA is still watching over, what my doctors are giving me. And like you talk about, Dave, that to go back to the time when you could go into the pharmacy or a store, you don't have to call it something special. It's just
yeah.
A
it
store.
Wasn't even a back then. It wasn't even a pharmacy. It was like we had talked about Kratom, how now they're schedule wanting it, but right now you can go into, I guess they call them head shops or
smoke shops.
You can go buy Kratom. Or there's a bunch of internet companies that sell it as well. So you can buy it just like you can buy anything else. And that's how all drugs used to be until 1914. I think it was called the Harris Act. Oh, wait, the Harris Act might have been first. They had a law where they had to list what was in it.
That was in 1906. Food and Drug Purity Act, I believe.
And then in 1914, I think then that was called the Harris Act. That's when they banned
the narcotics act.
Opiates was the first thing, and heroin. So, but before that, it wasn't pharmacies. It was just, you go to the store or, the same way, like I said, with Kratom, even though they don't sell it, at the supermarket, but that might just be because, I don't know.
They don't want to sell it.
For whatever reason.
It was on the DEA watch list for years.
I was just going to say that.
People got scared off of it.
Yeah. So, and it's just a plant, and they, schedule one day. But, so I interrupted you. So you were saying about going back to that.
Going back to the time when individuals understood that they owned themselves and that they could choose to consume a substance or they could choose not to. And I think that's where things are headed in this world, though. If you look at Colorado and the vote on cannabis, then Washington, Oregon, Alaska, and it's getting busted open. People are beginning to understand that individuals have the right to do that.
But I think with cannabis, and this is what worries me, is with cannabis, a lot of people that think it should be legal, they think it should be legal because it's not that bad, and they don't think the other drugs should be legal. And that's the problem, is they don't believe in self-ownership. They just think, hey, cannabis isn't that bad. That's fine. Legalize that. But heroin or opiates, don't legalize those. And I've heard that from a lot of people. I even got, somebody who is, somewhat, I guess, a libertarian. But
they'll say the same thing. Yeah.
He listed out, he's like, this one, yes, this one, no. So that's the problem, is if people don't get to that foundation of the self-ownership part, and they just think they're still looking at it from they're still deciding. They think
still
the government should.
Yeah.
They think the government should still control it. It's just that they think, this isn't that bad, so it should be legal. That's the only difference. So the people that think like that, nothing's changed. It just means that they think cannabis isn't that bad. That's it.
They just moved it into a different category. You're right about that. But I do have an issue with how cannabis is being treated in places where it's quote unquote legal.
Colorado, the tax is ridiculous. But sorry, go ahead into what you were.
Definitely, the taxes are crazy. And I've gone out there and actually toured the facilities. I've gone to different places.
I saw a documentary on the opening of one. Not a documentary, but it was like a show, documentary show, where there were like 10 episodes. And they showed, the opening, they showed the whole process, and they had to get all these permits, and it cost them like $100,000. It was like $100,000 to open the store.
Yeah. And they treat it like it's it's nuclear material, the way they track it from seed to
don't
sale.
Don't they like inspect it?
It's insanity.
The government's
very involved. Well, they have cameras 24 hours a day. Are those cameras everywhere?
But are those cameras that the yeah, that's what I was going to say. Are they linked?
They can look at them at any time.
That's fucked up. And this is in Colorado.
Yes, that's in Washington. I think has a better model than Colorado.
That is my. I'm glad you brought that up because that is my I have a serious problem with what they're doing. And if Kratom ever becomes legal, they're going to do the same thing. And that's what
it's control and money. Yeah.
You know, I want it to be treated like fucking Daryl Perry, who's a co-host on Free Talk Live, was on. He said, you know, cannabis should be treated like tomatoes, you know, and I think all drugs should be. I think he said all drugs and they should. Uh-huh. That it, as far as, I mean, less than fucking tomatoes, you know, because they probably inspect them more, you know.
Oh, like there's
you
can't a lot of regulations. Yeah.
So, I mean, it should be like aspirin, essentially, that all drugs should be treated like aspirin and they
or
should
weed,
be on the
which
shelf.
It really was, right? It was a weed that grew in the United States until Henry Anslinger started going around ripping it all up. So
it grew
naturally, yeah.
Yeah, and with the technology, you know, hopefully, and I don't know enough about it, people will grow all their own shit. You can grow fucking opium and coca leaves, mm-hmm. and, you know, I know that growing marijuana is not hard, but, you know, kratom, because all this stuff grows in, like, you know, Southeast Asia, a lot of it. Not cannabis. Cannabis will grow
South
in
America,
California, but... Sure. You know, all this other stuff will grow, either South America or opium is more Southeast Asia, and same with kratom. So, you know, there's technology, though, where you can grow stuff just in your own house, and
oh,
I don't
sure.
know how
yeah.
advanced it is. So I want to get to the Affordable Care Act briefly in the time that...
Sure.
We have left, and you know, maybe if we go a few minutes over, I don't know if you got right at one, but if we go a few minutes over, if that's okay. But because what I was saying too was that we talked about the DEA and how they're regulating anything that they deem. It's basically anything they deem affects, well, it's not even, I was going to say like affects your mood or alters your mind state, but that's not true because you have SSRIs, which I talk about all the time, how they give those away like nothing. You don't need any kind of, you could just go to the doctor and say, I'm depressed and get them. I mean,
right.
There's no check on them. They don't even know. They're not fully tested because they haven't even been around that long. So
and they don't know
people,
how they work. Yeah.
I mean, opium's been around for hundreds, more than that. I mean, you know, cocaine, not that I'm saying go do cocaine, but there's medical use for cocaine. It's Schedule 2. And, and of course, cannabis, you know, has been around for so long. But you have these SSRIs, and they give them away like nothing, which is – that's okay for that, though, right? And that's because the pharmaceutical companies make all the money off them. But
yep.
So they're kind of hypocrites in that sense because they don't care about those, the DEA, I guess because there's no money in them. But supposedly they schedule – anything that's mind-altering is dangerous somehow. So whatever. That's their rationale. But so between the DEA and not being able to self-medicate basically anything that's illegal or things that are legal, doctors are like the control, the guy at the door. They're in control of all this. We can't write our own fucking prescriptions. But, oh, you become a doctor that somehow, you know, you get all this control.
They're just permission
slips. They're taking
slips,
it away from
you know?
Them. I know. Yeah. That's kind of what it is.
That's
all
it is.
That's
a
good way to put
slip.
It.
It's like we're in high school and we got to go to the bathroom. You know?
You're not responsible enough. You need a parent, i.e. a doctor, to tell you that your pain is bad enough that you need to get painkillers. Yep. You need his permission slip. That is a perfect way to put it. So along with that, now you have doctors so worried about that shit because, I mean, pain is a common thing and something that, you know, out of all the illnesses, I think the one that needed drugs the most, besides maybe a bacterial infection, although a lot of those will go away on their own. You know, your immune system, it's better to build up your fucking immune system because they're having all these strains of bacteria now that they can't even kill with antibiotics. So in a virus, there is no fucking thing you can do. So I think the most important drug, or really the only drug that really matters, is fucking when you're in pain because you can't do anything else.
It's really crazy.
Make it go away any other. I mean, you could try to meditate or something, but if you're in intense pain, you know, you can't get it to go away. I mean, really, that's the only thing I think medication you can solve. You can't solve with anything else but medication. And, of course, as well. But, I mean, the pain that I had also, I mean, you can't really solve it with anything but medication. Now, it can be natural medication, but it's got to be something. You know, you can solve other things where they'll just go away on their own or, you know, you can deal with
them. A cut will heal. Yeah.
Yeah. Broken bones, you know, that you might be in pain because of it, but I mean the bone part of it, and even colds. I mean, you know, so it's ridiculous. So you have that, and the whole crackdown on it, and the whole we're gonna make this about, you know, because of painkillers, people are heroin addicts, which really it's so not the case. It's the other way around because the government makes it hard to get them. People turn to heroin.
Right.
And then so you have Obamacare. And so what I just want to mention a couple things about Obamacare and then get your thoughts on it. So not only first of all, half of the stuff I read some of the bill. I scanned through it and I read the stuff that I really wanted to know about. And it's 1,000 pages, so I didn't read a lot of it. But I read the stuff that I read as I scanned through it. Were the things that I thought were really important. One of them being the databases. So all your information now, your medical information, like we talked about spying, is in a database. And in the bill, it says that they want to be able to view your information because they want to view outcomes. So they want to be able to review, you know, outcomes. Which is basically another excuse to take all that information they collected on you. And just like you're saying, they have the drug database. Well, they also have, you know, it doesn't even really matter because they have the database of what you were treated for. Now it's more specific. I think they made it more specific because so they could know what was wrong with you and look at it. To be able to look at the code and have a better idea, you know.
Well,
I think
too, Dave. Yeah, I think it's a way to track
to give them
all
more
these
information.
Outcomes. Yeah, and the information is going to be used by government, but it's also going to be used by pharmaceutical companies, and they've got this huge spy network out there now, ran by the National Institute of Health and enforced by the IRS. That they have all these electronic documents that they're getting funneled every moment of every day. And just to think about privacy for a moment, I'm sharing everything I am voluntarily, but think about how Hillary Clinton treated the most top secret documents basically in the United States, how she treated that, what she thought of those documents. What do you think the average federal bureaucrat thinks about your medical health care?
Oh, yeah, your information is just, I mean, look at, you know, even with Snowden, he talked about all the people who had access to your information. So, I mean, your medical information is right there. And unlike your other information, they actually put it in the bill. You know, we know they were going to take it anyway. I mean, that's right. Just they were going to take it even if it was in the bill. But they specifically also put it in the bill and gave a bullshit reason. So then they added, what, like 50 to 100,000 new medical codes and for medical billing to the insurance companies. But I think one of the reasons, and you'd probably know more about this than me, but is, like I was saying, and you talked about the pharmaceutical companies, but also so they know just from the code more specifics on what's wrong with you. So they want to know your medical history. They want to know, you know, just like they want to know all the other stuff. So they know that you were treated, and they can tell by the medical code better now. Before, it was more generic, so they didn't
more
really
vague.
Know. Right. Mm-hmm. So you had more, more like when the insurance company looked at it, they didn't know all the details that maybe you told
the doctors,
your doctor.
Yeah, right. The doctors had gray area where they could, you know, say one thing, but it was really for something else, just because they wanted to use this medication or.
But
or
it was
have an
it was less
that,
specific.
Yeah. Right.
So, and I'm sure it also has to do with billing and limited what they can bill for and prescribe
insurance
and all that
stuff. Companies. Yeah.
I know it has to do with that, but I think it also has to do with the fact that the government can tell more specifically from the code, and doctors can't give a generic code. It's more specific, so they'll have more information about you.
Well, if the government, if they want to control, if they want to do a top-down healthcare system, they want all the information that they can get, because what they look at, they're allocating resources, and all we are numbers on a chart, and they'll say, oh, well, you're past the age of 80. You're not going to get these resources. You're under the age of 3. And there's actually Cass Sunstein. He has documents that says a person under the age of 5 is not a real person, and that they should not be given healthcare resources in a government-run healthcare plan.
No, and you should so just kill them?
Well, let them die. And yeah. The older people don't need it either.
Yeah.
There was a Rockefeller. I think he's still in the in the Congress, he talked about how I think it's like 50% of all healthcare costs are in the last 6 months of life. And he talked about his father who was killed in a car wreck. And he was so thankful for that he was dead, because if he had lived, there's no way that he was going to give him any kind of healthcare at the end of his life. He would have just pulled the plug on him, let him die.
Well,
so these people are so tyrannical. And they have such a disdain for the average person that if individuals who aren't in this world actually listen to their conversations, they would be absolutely blown away by them.
Well, you got Bill Gates and all the shit that he says about eliminating, you know, there's too many people. And yep. And he has said things that makes the whole, well, you know, the conspiracy to eliminate population, which is bullshit that, you know, there's not enough resources and whatever. I mean, you could fit.
That is a lie.
It's either the whole country or the whole world into the state of Texas comfortably. And I mean,
it is totally
oils everywhere. It's just such bullshit. But he actually had talked about that, you know, and in different ways like that. And this is the guy who basically came up, the Bill Gates Foundation, or Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, was involved in Common Core as well, and gave a lot of money to that. But the other thing I came across that was very disturbing, not because of what it is, but what it I think it's going to become. And this is the they started some kind of council, or there's a name for it, I can't remember, but it lists basically recommendations of all these things you should have, like on an annual basis or whatever. And some of the shit on it is nuts. It's like all women should have a domestic violence screening.
Oh my God.
Everybody should have an alcohol screening.
Wow.
Whether, you know, like shit like that. And I know what's going to happen is, because they do this already, like when you get insurance, like at work, at least for mine, it asks, do you smoke? Do you agree to live a healthy lifestyle?
And they'll do that with weight and everything else too.
And it gives you discounts, right, based on that.
Right.
And what's going to happen is they're going to have all these things that you have to do And if you do them, you'll get discounts on your insurance. Otherwise, you won't. And they're going to make insurance ridiculously expensive if you don't get those. And the whole fine is going to go up. They want to call it a tax, well, extortion, whatever. It's a fucking fine.
It's still theft.
It's going to keep going up, where it's going to be even a percentage of your fucking income.
Sure. And it never works anywhere. It's been tried, you know, centralized healthcare. So it's a failure before they even start.
Right. Well, that's supposedly what they wanted, because they want to go to single payer.
Yeah.
And there are alternatives. Like, there's concierge medicine, where you can have a doctor where you pay like $400 a month. Well, you pay them $400 a month, and you can see them as many times as you want. The only problem is, you know, if you have surgeries or stuff at the hospital and things like that, that's extra money. But you could see your doctor, you know, basically for free, and you pay just a monthly fee, and you see him, you know, whenever. And that takes insurance. You know, he calculates how many patients. Plus, you get more, you know, better care, because he only has a certain amount of patients. He calculates, well, I need 400 patients to make enough money if I charge 300 a month or whatever. And, you know, there's that's an option. But it's bad. And I don't know, you know, I'm scared to have kids because of, you know, they got to go to the doctor all the time. And supposedly when they're younger, and if you don't take them, I guess you're neglecting them. You know, and I'm thinking about that and all the tracking, and, you know, that's why I wouldn't send, if I had kids, I'd homeschool them. My wife would stay home with them, and, you know, I'd try to keep them as much out of the system as possible.
Yeah, definitely. It's set up to ensnare and to enslave the current government, banking, medical care system. And there's people out there who benefit by the more laws that are laid upon us all. And that just makes life harder to live for people who are sick, or anybody who's working, or anybody who wants to start a business. All of these ideas of communism, progressivism, governance, is that it makes it harder to accomplish what you want to accomplish in life.
Yeah. Well, I think that.
No, you're right.
They want, doctors to be another form of control, where when you go to your doctor, they want to set that up as basically it's another form of control and of them getting information. And that's another goal where, you know, some people can't avoid doctors, and at some point, you know, no matter who you are, you're probably going to have to go to one. And that's where they can get people. I know, just briefly, and then I'll let you, you know, say whatever closing stuff you want to say before you go, a friend who used to be a co-host on the show said that they were asking his son all these questions about his parents. You know, and I don't know, he was like 12 or 13 or 14 at the time, something like that. And, you know, they asked, I think, if you have a gun at home, if, you know, whatever, you know, all this information. And doctors now are becoming like, you know, CIA agents or informants or whatever.
Sure.
So that's why, I mean, I know you're in a situation, obviously, where you have to see, you know, doctors all the time, and there's really no, and I actually go to the doctor, well, I don't want to really say on air, but, because I have a issue, whatever, that, so, you
and
know,
it should be private, Dave. You should only share what you want to share with the people you want to share it with. That's what the people who founded the government in the United States had some great ideas. And one of them was that you have an inherent right to privacy.
Well, right. But I don't care as far as, you know, people knowing. I care more about government and police and whatever, having more information, personal information about me, you know, not that it would really matter. I just, you know,
it's sad we even have to think about that in this country. And there was one guy, who David Seaman, I don't know if you follow him or not, but he got fired from the Huffington Post because he linked to Paul Joseph Watson's YouTube video about Hillary's health. And so David Seaman got fired. Yeah, and he talked about in the video, he was talking about getting fired at Sunday night at like 11 o'clock at night with no explanation. And the first thing out of his mouth, he's like, I'm not suicidal. You know, I love life. So if anything happens to me, you'll know where to look. And to say that in America and to think that and to feel that, you know, that destroys so much good things in the world when you have to worry about a tyrannical government.
They killed Michael Hastings. They blew his car up.
That's right.
And there's no doubt. Even the witnesses say the engine flew out of his car. And then the police that investigated, oh no, it was just a car accident. It's crazy. But I know you got to go, so I want to give you a chance to just whatever you want to close with. Go ahead.
Sure. Thank you, Dave. Just want to talk to folks who are struggling with health issues and that, and people who are not. Health is really the foundation of freedom. If you're wondering what you can do to advance the cause of freedom for yourself and for your family and for the country and for the world, is to get healthier every day.
Listen to my show.
Yeah, there you go. Listen to Dave's show. Definitely. These shows are important to connect with people who share similar ideas. But your health, if you're not physically and mentally and emotionally healthy, then you're carrying around, it's like carrying around extra shackles. And the government already taxes you enough. The government already regulates you enough. And there's tools out there to help you to be healthier today. And a lot of that has to do with what you eat. I'm actually a primal blueprint coach now. And so that's just the idea that the paleo primal lifestyle is more beneficial than versus what the standard American diet is. And basically is to question everything and don't be afraid to stand up for what you believe in. I think that the government wants us to submit and to stay silent. And I'm done doing that. I'm done submitting and I'm done staying silent. So I'm going to be out there talking about legalizing cannabis in Georgia. I'm going to be talking about out there about medical freedom. And I hope other people who care about this will be doing the same.
All right. Well, that's all the time we have for tonight. I'd like to thank Brad for coming on. And that's some great information. Go check out his websites. You can find them on any of the archives. So any of the archives that you go to, they'll be there in the notes or details or whatever. But it's healthier. And Brad, tell me if I have them wrong. Today, sure. with a two. So 2day.com. And
correct.
Then the other one, easy, legalizedcannabisingeorgia.com.
And I know that's a creative name, so I wanted to go.
Well, it's an easy one to remember. So
there you go. That's why I did it.
That's the best, you know, the best websites are the ones that have names that are easy to remember. So go check out Brad's websites and his articles or blogs on medical freedom. And there's one recent one from the third that I have the link to, but I don't want to give the whole link. But you can get the link at the archives, and you can just go to the page healthiertoday.com, and you'll find the article and other stuff there. So thanks again, man, for coming on. I really appreciate it, and you gave some great information, and it was a lot of fun having you on.
Thanks, Dave, man. I appreciate what you're doing, and you starting up this network and putting the time in to do this. It takes a lot of sacrifice to do this, and anybody out there who's debating about calling in or starting their own show or starting a podcast or a blog, and I just want to tell them, just do it, man. Just go ahead and put the time in. It does make a difference. And over time, things do change, and they can change for the better.
Yeah, and I'm always looking for new shows as well. So anybody out there that you know, has the same ideas. You know, I'm looking for new shows. So now that we're 24/7, even before that, actually, I was looking for shows as well. So, and different types of things, not just, you know, the type of show I do, but if you're somebody who really believes in true freedom and liberty, and you have different topics that you know, a specific thing that you are an expert in or whatever, that, you know, that's fine. I think we need shows that aren't necessarily about freedom, but are done by people who present it in a freedom way, just like, you know, Brad, you're doing, you know, medical freedom, you know, so things like that are what I'm looking for. So thanks again, man. And we will be back tomorrow with Ken Shorjan from the Daily Economist. So tune in for that. I'm sure Ken got a lot of news, especially with the ceasefire being broken in Syria. So tune in tomorrow, and thanks everybody for tuning in tonight. I really appreciate it. And of course, thanks again to Brad for joining us. And have a good night, everybody.
If you're white, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime. We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're white, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force